Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments. Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
All right, if we could come to order, please. This is the October 21st, 2019, 7 p.m. meeting of Alamance County Board of Commissioners. I'm Chair Amy Gailey, and present tonight we have Commissioner Sutton, Vice Chair Boswell, Commissioner Lashley, and Commissioner Carter. So, welcome to everyone, and Commissioner Lashley, I believe you have the invocation.
I do. Let us all pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we pause at this time to honor you. We honor you because you are worthy of honor. We praise you because you are worthy of praise. We ask you to continue to bless our nation, bless our nation's leaders. And we ask you to, as we set about to do the people's business, that you just bless us and do what then help us to do the right thing. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
To the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, we have a few people signed up for public speaking tonight on agenda-related items. Remind everybody, all the speakers, that you have 3 minutes to make your remarks. And that there is a public comment policy that is available to be reviewed on our website. Anybody who is thinking about coming to speak, we ask you to review that. But that being said, the first person signed up is Jane Lee Hicks.
My name is Jane Lee Hicks, and I live in Snow Camp. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can.
I would like to thank the commissioners and the planning board and the planning department for addressing the deficiencies in our 2011 HIDO, which resulted in a calamitous situation we have in Snow Camp, and the HIDO permit issued to C. Wayne McDonald, manager of Snow Camp Property Investments. Our community is hopeful the revised HIDO will better balance the health, safety, and well-being of the citizens with the county's plans for economic development. I would like to address a few points of concern that might warrant your thoughts and consideration. First is land spacing. In the absence of zoning, the land spacing must provide a protective buffer for nearby homeowners. So, Mr. Carter, you suggested that a 1,300-foot spacing from the property line for Class 3 high-impact industries might be too restrictive. As a frame of reference for the mining operation proposed in Snow Camp, the state required a survey of over 80 water wells within 1,500 feet of the property. This indicates a concern for groundwater impact up to that distance. Another example, non-zoned Ash County's 2016 high-impact land ordinance requires that a high-impact land use shall not be located nearer to a protected site than 2,000 feet, measured from the area of operation to the protected site. And so I believe that a 1,300-foot spacing requirement is not overly restrictive and is in keeping with normal and customary practices in the industry. Another concern I have is that the revision does not include as protective facilities utility pipelines and easements. Where I appreciate Colonial Pipeline's $12,000 grant and disaster training program they provided for the Snow Camp Volunteer Fire Department, I think it would be a good idea to safeguard in advance against such a catastrophe. Additionally, there are no provisions for groundwater protection, which could include a requirement for a site-specific groundwater study, as is required by several of our surrounding counties. And finally, Mr. Sutton, his question several times if the commissioners could possibly reasonably say that they don't want a specific industry in an area of the county. And it seems you can under certain discretionary provisions. For example, the special permit requirements for quarries in Burlington include a determination by the Board of Adjustment that the location and character of be of harmony with the area in which it is to be located and in general conformity with the plan of development of Burlington and its environs. Orange County's Unified Development Ordinance states its purpose to accomplish compatible development of land within the county in a manner which will best promote the health, safety, and general welfare, as well as to secure safety from fire, panic, and other hazards, provide for the protection of the surface and underground water resources, promote desirable living conditions, and the sustained stability of neighborhoods in accordance with the comprehensive plan for the county. I believe you could add a similar authority to our HIDO that would reference conformity with our own Vision Alamance plan.
Thank you.
All right, next is Gary Ulickney.
Gary, how are you doing?
I'm great. You guys remember me?
Yeah.
What's your name?
We know how to pronounce it.
That's right. You're one of the few. That's how I can tell if it's a robocall or not. Good evening. My name is Gary Ulickney, and I reside in Snow Camp, North Carolina. First, as a community, we'd like to thank the Planning Board for all the hard work they have put into revising our flawed HIDO, and the Commissioners for listening to citizens of Alamance County on this important issue. While we heartily support the changes that you have been proposed, we have two very important recommendations. First, as you know, because Alamance is mostly a rural county, many of its citizens and businesses, especially agriculture, rely on clean, abundant groundwater for both drinking water and their livelihood. Heavy industrial development, especially those industries that use large quantities of groundwater, threaten areas that have no access to municipal water. An excellent example of this is Alamance Aggregate's proposed quarry that says in their state application they will be pumping 500,000 gallons a day from the local aquifer. While the state does address this, by that time there's little opportunity for recourse of local residents. In fact, the state is still trying to get a comprehensive hydrogeological study from Alamance Aggregates over a year later. This issue has been the prime concern of residents of Snow Camp, who are anxiously awaiting this key information. Most counties, for example, Orange and Guilford, require comprehensive groundwater impact studies during the county permit application process. This gives citizens an opportunity to challenge reports that indicate a threat to local wells at the public hearing. Adding similar language to our HIDO has been suggested to the Planning Board, but the response from staff has been we don't have adequate staff to do this. This process should not require additional staff, as the report would be paid for entirely by the applicant and submitted with their application along with other required information. The applicant would engage a licensed hydrogeologist who would evaluate the impact of the proposed development and submit that report. Second, our community has been appalled at the veiled secrecy Snow Camp Property Investments and Alamance Aggregates has employed in this application process. One second. This behavior has only caused increased anxiety and suspicion among Snow Camp residents. Citizens have a right to know who's behind these intrusive developments. We strongly urge the commissioners to add language in the new HIDO requiring companies disclose ownership, provide any history of criminal activities, and provide information on their prior experience and safety record in similar projects they've been involved in. Again, thanks for your efforts. We hope that you include our recommendations in the HIDO revision and provide some comfort to citizens affected by these developments. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ulickney. Ron Spinoven.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I am Snow Camp resident Ron Spinoven, regarding the Alamance Aggregates location and permit in Snow Camp. As you know, the last few months, the Piedmont has been experiencing severe drought conditions. Thankfully, we got a little relief yesterday, but as sure as the climate is changing, these conditions will continue to worsen as time goes by. Flooding will increase, followed by longer periods of drought. Allowing a corporation to come into our county and deplete 500,000 gallons of our precious water every day for 50 years is unconscionable. They will be robbing us of our future, a future dependent on water from our aquifers. Ironically, the last season of the latest season of the series Goliath centers around an unscrupulous corporate almond grower's nefarious scheme to steal the water from local aquifers. Left with dried up wells, residents and farmers must buy water to drink, cook, and bathe. I fear this will happen here. I implore you to take the high road and stop this potential catastrophe while you still can, whatever it takes. Once this train has left the station, we will not be able to walk it back. In closing, I feel compelled to make a comment regarding one of the things that disturbed me while watching the October 7th meeting. I listened to the county planner suggest that the state might show a puddle on the map, followed shortly after by the county attorney reiterating that a puddle might be considered a navigable body of water. These are the kind of ridiculous statements people make when they don't have a good answer to a reasonable question. Frankly, they are an insult to our intelligence and have become all too commonplace these days. I share Commission Chair Galley's frustration when she said, "How can we not know that after a year?" Regarding identifying which maps have been used for permit applications. And by the way, we do get more than a few puddles on our property after a good rain, and anyone is welcome to bring a boat over and try to navigate one of them. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Henry Vines.
Henry Wilson.
Thank you, Commissioner. My name is Henry Vines, and I'm from Snow Camp, farmer down there. As each and every one of you know, I've always been an advocate of the sales tax. And the reason I support the sales tax is so that we can have a lower property tax rate. In the discussions at last meeting, it kind of was a little bit disturbing to me is that there was notions that we're going to increase spending and use part of the money if we get a 4 cent sales tax put in and maybe take a little off of property taxes. My whole intent on this whole deal was that when we started from the beginning is to impose the sales tax versus property tax. We failed to do that as voters. The option was still available to you as commissioners going through the General Assembly. I understand the frustrations that has gone on, being that the people have said no, and then we go and ask for it. But in the same time, we're imposed an 8 cent property tax increase. And in that 8 cent property tax, we were led to believe that this is going to be enough money to handle everything. We won't need no more taxes. I stood right up here on this podium and I said, I just don't believe that's enough. But y'all assured me that that was going to be enough. And now it's coming back that we're going to need more money to operate with. And we don't know whether we're going to end up having to borrow more money because the expense is going up. It may even take more money than we have originally stopped. We keep borrowing money, doing more projects, spending more money, bigger government. I think each and every one of you up here has told me at one time we want a smaller government, we want less spending. And it don't seem like that's happening. I would like to recommend to you that you not put this sales tax back on the ballot again, because I don't feel like that it's going to pass. And I think that we should wait, see how things go. If we need more revenues for the county, then go to the General Assembly and ask. If you ask the people in this county to raise taxes on their sale, it ain't never going to happen. It ain't happened that three times. And I don't feel like it's going to happen on the fourth time. We're paying enough property taxes. We don't need no raise. Y'all need to work on this and keep this property tax down and work with the amount of money you got and make it work. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Vines. Okay, do we have any commissioner responses?
Yeah, I'd like to ask a question. Clyde, the lady that spoke first that referred to Burlington and Orange County, I assume that's because of zoning they were allowed to do that possibly?
That's correct.
But don't we pretty much have ingrained or in our, like, we can't just put a landfill anywhere, and that's not in not its own county. Yeah.
Well, the state regulates location of landfills. That'd be line.
Well, that's line, not location.
I mean, we just can't put a landfill somewhere. So don't we already have ingrained in our infrastructure? We outlined that we are cognizant of people's neighborhoods and proximity to houses and so forth.
I think we do. The high-dome that you're talking about amending was a replacement for the high-impact land use ordinance, which was developed because the previous ordinance didn't work. And when paint oil, I've told the story before, paint oil had need to move. They couldn't move anywhere in the town because of the space. Mr. Boswell was on the land board. At the time, we came up with the first high-dome. But what we did with that is just we moved problems all over the county rather than concentrating it in the areas where it could be. That's what zoning does. That's why you've got a plan to come up with a land use reduction plan, which is probably what we should have had 15, 20 years ago.
Well, the highway was actually originally written to stop an asphalt plant, which wanted to go into an industrial park. So
that was a heavy industry that, heavy industry ordinance.
Mm-hmm.
And that was written to stop the asphalt. And what it did was it prevented paint oil from moving right. When the railroad came in and wanted to widen it. And then you came up with a high dome, which was the best thing they did. And that was 9 months of hard work for the folks to come up with that, but it had its flaws.
Mm-hmm.
As you know, it's had its flaws.
We didn't have the checks in there that we needed for us to know that what was going on with it.
And I think it's because we focused on helping a business if you wanted to stay in your county, find a place to move, rather than focusing on other businesses that might want to do that. That's what we found out.
Any other commissioner response?
Could we ask the speakers to speak up so that we can hear? Thank you.
Any other commissioner response?
I'll go.
Use
the microphone.
Any other commissioner response? Nope. Okay. All right, then next is for approval of the agenda. If everybody has had the opportunity to review the agenda. We have a motion and a second to approve the agenda. If there's no discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Next, we have the consent agenda, a few items on there. Everybody's.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second to approve the consent agenda. If there's no more no discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay. Now we get on to the fun stuff with a proclamation for Red Ribbon Week. And that's what we were taking the picture for before the meeting started. So we have a proclamation, and I think we have Chase Davis and Lauricel Acevedo, who are going to Trinity Fawcett is with them, and Mr. Jim Albright. They represent the Alamance Citizens for a Drug-Free Community, and you can come on up, and I think Chase is going to read the proclamation for us.
Yes, he is. Mm-hmm. I was just going to give you a couple of facts about Red Ribbon Week before we get started. It's the oldest and largest drug prevention program in the nation, reaching millions of young people during Red Ribbon Week, which is October 23rd through the 31st of this each year. The Red Ribbon campaign was started when drug traffickers in Mexico City murdered DEA agent Kiki Camarnero in 1985. This began the continuing tradition of displaying red ribbons as a symbol of intolerance towards the use of drugs. The mission of the Red Ribbon campaign is to present a unified and visible commitment towards the creation of a drug-free America. Now I'm going to turn it over to these students from Cummings, and we also from, I'm sorry, Broadview. I also have Jasmine Morrison, who is their school counselor, with us this evening.
Welcome. Glad to have you all.
This is the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, Red Ribbon Week, October 23rd to 31st, 2019. Whereas alcohol and other substance misuse in this nation has reached epidemic stages, affecting people from all communities and of all ages, races, and ethnic backgrounds. And whereas it is imperative that visible and unified prevention, education, treatment, and recovery efforts, including harm reduction efforts, be launched and supported to eliminate the demand for drugs, to mitigate drug-related harm, promote the health and well-being of all people, and whereas local calibration of concerned groups, sectors, systems, and individuals working together toward the common goal of enhancing a community of care by addressing the factors in homes, schools, and communities that increase the risk of substance misuse and promoting the factors that minimize the risk of substance misuse.
Whereas the National Family Partnership of Alamance Citizens for a Drug-Free Community are sponsoring the National Red Ribbon Campaign, offering citizens the opportunity to demonstrate their commitment to a substance-free lifestyle, no misuse of legal or illegal substances. And whereas the National Red Ribbon Campaign will be celebrated in every community in America during Red Ribbon Week, October 23rd to 31st. And whereas business, government, parents, law enforcement, media, medical, religious institutions, schools, senior citizens, service organizations, youth, and others will demonstrate their commitment to healthy, drug-free lifestyles by wearing and displaying red ribbons during this week-long campaign.
And whereas Alamance County further commits its resources to the success of the Red Ribbon Campaign, now therefore be it resolved that the Alamance County Board of Commissioners does hereby proclaim October 23 to 31st, 2019 as Red Ribbon Week and encourages its citizens to participate in substance misuse prevention and education activities and making a visible statement that we are strongly committed to a drug-free community. Adopted this 21st day of October 2019. So, great. Here is your copy. And
Chair, I need to ask you a question. You two,
yes, sir.
Young individuals, Bobcats.
Yes.
Just checking to see if they had their mask on, right?
I'm just giving them a secret test question. My kids went Broadview, by the way.
Okay.
Maybe
okay.
Bobcats, too.
All right. Mr. Albright, is there anything else we need to do for
No, that's good. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for coming and good luck. And we enjoyed having you.
Thank you for having us.
Okay. Next on our agenda is a request for an excise tax. Refund. We have a couple of gentlemen.
I didn't need these 5 years ago.
It's terrible. And it gets worse.
Yeah. It does, unfortunately.
I'm sorry, I didn't say we have Paul Ortel and Tom Steele here.
Good evening, commissioners, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Paul Ortel, and I'm an attorney here in Burlington. I'm here tonight before you to request a refund of an overpayment of a revenue stamp involving a transaction in which I was involved in. Before you should be correspondence from seller's counsel outlining the nature of the issue and the cause thereof. Simply put, we missed it. All of our documents were very neat and organized, but we failed to correct the revenue stamp when a change occurred. The net result is the seller overpaid by $700. I am here to request a refund of those funds. I will be glad to answer any questions you may have.
Motion.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve that refund. Is there any discussion? I think the reason we have to do, sometimes we do tax refunds on consent, but this is involving the register of deeds, so I don't think we could do it under consent. So we have a motion and a second. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right, thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
All right, next on the agenda is a Snow Camp Quarry permit discussion. And I'd asked for this to be on the agenda tonight because I had concerns following our last meeting. I felt like there were still some questions about the issuance of the permit, whether or not the county had done everything it was supposed to in issuing the permit, and also whether or not the applicant had been entirely forthcoming with truth in its permit application. So I asked this to be on here, and I don't know if you gentlemen have any thoughts to share.
Well, if nobody else has any comment, I'd like to make a motion. I've thought about this a lot, and we've heard a lot about this issue. And I don't want anybody that's currently employed with Alamance County to think that what I'm getting ready to propose is in any way reflecting on anybody that's employed, because they weren't involved in the improvement process. There's been a lot of insinuation from the attorneys for the snow camp citizens about some errors that may have occurred in the process. And in that light, I'd like to propose that we have, or that we engage a third-party professional firm or individual to review the approval process for the Alamance aggregates permit to determine that the information provided and that the decisions that were made are consistent with the HIDO that was in place at the time, and that the necessary steps were taken to ensure the accuracy of the process and to protect the citizens of Alamance County.
I'll second that motion.
Okay. What discussion?
Well, I would like to know. I know we had talked about this earlier with you and mentioned it in one of our meetings that this is a possibility of doing that. Have you checked with who might would be in over this or be able to do this?
So I had at the instruction of the board, I'd reached out to some of our local council of governments, thinking that we have some that have planning expertise. Did not reach out to the one that we're a member of, reached out to some other ones in the event they were able to do it, then we wouldn't be in a position of paying dues to somebody to review us. That's correct. One of the two that I reached out to felt like that was not something that they would want to be involved, and the other I never heard back from, so I took that as they may have reached that decision too. So I'm not sure from the COGS and the central, the councils of government that we would get this kind of support. So it may be there's some other professional or some other service that we would want to look into.
Mr. Albright, you and I had a conversation about this topic, and did you find any attorneys that would be able to
an attorney in Asheville who regularly provides advice to the General Assembly on these matters, and I would suggest, if it's the board's wish, I'll call it CP to review the permit as the motion is laid out.
I have the particular questions that I have that I would like answered by a reviewing party, if it's an attorney. One, did the county make a mistake in granting the permit? Two, did the applicant say anything that later proved to be untruthful or less than truthful in the permit application? Three, if either the answer to those questions is yes, either the county made an error or the applicant was less than truthful, what, if anything, can the county do now to remedy that? And then four, I would like to know if there's a statute of limitations that applies. Since it's been over a year since the permit was granted, that would be kind of wrapped up into the third question, if there's anything that we can do about it. Is there a statute of limitations that applies?
Well, one of the issues I was concerned about, too, was the fact that there were two different maps provided, one provided to the county and one provided to the state.
Right. I was interested in that, too, why that was and whether it has any impact on the counties having granted the permit. So we have a motion and a second. Is there any more discussion?
I might ask the process for, you're going to tell us who this is after you...
I haven't contacted him yet, so I don't know if he's available, but I'll email him. And I can email all of you tomorrow.
Do you have an alternate that Mike would be able to?
Not yet.
Okay.
Yeah, this person, if can do it, will probably make a suggestion.
We have some local attorneys who work for other municipalities who might be available to review it and wouldn't have to travel or anything.
Well, I don't anticipate this person traveling. I'll just send the file to him.
All right. Another thought. Oh, I would like for the person to report directly to the board. And I was thinking maybe they could do it for $225 an hour, which is kind of a government rate.
I think you might be limiting yourself.
Just make, well, ask make a suggestion.
That's about what Harrington Smith charges the school board. And
why don't I do this? Why don't I come back with a proposal?
That would be nice. And would there a report be covered under attorney-client privilege if we're doing this under the idea?
It's made to you in a closed session?
Yes.
Under, because we are pretty much asking for this, thinking that preparing for a potential lawsuit. Okay, so we have a motion and a second. Is there any more discussion?
Yeah, I was talking to Steve. I would hope that we would be able to sit down and discuss with this person, both sides, what we think our input is, to see if they see evidence or our suspicions. Like, I have suspicions. I think everybody's got some suspicions about
we certainly,
the whole process.
Certainly start with a meeting with the board.
Yeah,
I would suggest if he agrees to do this and go to that.
Okay, if there's no further discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you. All right, Dr. Gabewood, we have an update about our bond projects from Alamance Community College.
Madam Chair, good evening. Members of the Commission, thank you very much for the opportunity to share with you where we are with our bond projects. Let me just mention before I get started that I consider, as in terms of the team here tonight, Sheriff Johnson to be a member. We have General Blake Williams, who is the is a member of our Board of Trustees, and he also chairs the Building and Grounds Committee, so he has a great interest in this project. We'll talk about three projects tonight, and for one of those projects, the location of the property where we would like to place our training center, Martin Marietta, and in terms of the lease agreement for that property, we have Ms. Kate Glaze, who is the Assistant General Counsel and Director of Martin Marietta Lands, and I will ask her to share in this presentation with me in a few minutes. We also have Mr. Frank Longis here, and of course there are some members of the town of Green Level who are present, Mr. and Mrs. McCollum, who has a great interest in this project. You have this presentation in front of you, is that right?
I think it's up and ready.
Okay, so it's written in.
Yes.
All right. So to begin, we have several projects, but I want to focus, as I mentioned, on the BioTech Center of Excellence, the parking, and the Public Safety Training Center. There's not much action with the other projects now, so I want to bore you with that. Public Safety Training Center, just as a reminder, will include a burn center, a burn pit, and a burn building, six classrooms, a dedicated shooting simulation space, basic law enforcement training, a sizable driving pad for emergency vehicle maneuvers, and the future emergency medical services. And of course, we may be able to achieve some of that with this bond measure. The property is located, the Martin Marietta property, that we would like your approval to move forward with. It's located on the corner of Santa Cross Road and North Carolina Highway 49, and that is a 50-acre property, what you see here. And adjacent to that is an additional 43 acres. So here's the deal. The proposed lease agreement, and this was negotiated by several of us in this room, including the sheriff, Sheriff Johnson. The agreement would provide 50 acres of property for the training center to be constructed. That property would be made available to us via a lease for 1,800, I mean, I'm sorry, 18,000 $817 per year. The first 3 years of that lease would be free, so there'd be no charge. It would give us time to get the building planned and constructed. The 43 acres adjacent to the 50 acres would be provided to us free of charge. And as it stands, that would be on a year-to-year lease agreement. The total investment would be $10,400 for the design of the facility, which has already been, that has been approved. Of course, the lease payments would be a total of $884 over the 47-year period. Now, annual operating cost is really pretty good for a property of that size, $117,000 a year. So at this time, I would ask Ms. Kate Blaze if she would come and add some comments regarding Martin Marietta's interest in assisting us with this project. Kate?
Thank you, Dr. Gateway. My name is Kate Glaze. I'm an assistant, a general counsel at Martin Marietta. I handle real estate transactions, and I'm also their director of land. Ward and I, our president and CEO, wished he could be here tonight, and he was unable to rearrange travel to be here, so I get to stand in his stead. I'm primarily here to tell you how enthusiastic and supportive we are about this project. Martin Marietta is very interested in supporting this center. We have been at our East Alamance quarry for many years as a member of the community. We understand the importance of this project to the community, to the county, to the college, and we think this is a way that we can help. We've been engaged with the sheriff and the community college for at least a year now, probably longer. At least I've personally been engaged for a year. And I was going to give you an overview of the lease, but I think you have it. But I just want to again express our enthusiasm and thank you for the opportunity to be here. I'm happy to answer any questions you have about the property or the lease to the extent I can.
Did I understand you that it's going to be $18,000 a year?
Correct. About
$18,800. You can't rent any houses in that.
And we came to that number by looking, talking to a local appraiser and getting a fair market value analysis of the property and discounting that for a ground lease. We could give more details. I don't have it in front of me, but it was we tried to come up with a rationale here. And then again, the 43 acres are rent free.
Have you got any other projects in the state or southeast or whatever that's similar to this or that you've done in the past?
No. Honestly, this is a one of a kind for us. I think what's unique about this project for us is that the site would be built on current reserves that have not yet been mined out. So we do have a history of having projects, especially with governments, done on land once it's no longer being mined. But the unique feature for us here is that this is not yet mined, and we hope you take from that that this is important and unique and special for us.
How long has the quarry been closed there?
Well, the land is adjacent to an operating quarry, so it's really, we think of it as one large site, so I don't know that number.
Okay, so it's mm-hmm. still operating.
Right, I know it was historically two, and we operated this one.
Okay.
I think I understand that the 43 acres of joining it is mm-hmm. on a year-to-year basis versus not for the 50.
Correct, and that's to reflect the fact that there's no rent for it. I think it's mostly creek land that would be used as search and rescue training, is what I've been told. So it doesn't need infrastructure improvement. It's the other reason it seemed like that structure might work.
I'd like to make a motion to approve if that's in order.
I'm not sure that we need a motion tonight. I think this was for information tonight.
It is. Commissioners, what I'm listening for to hear is we're at a point with this project that the college needs to start doing some intensive planning right. if we're going to use this property. We're very grateful for Martin Marietta allowing us to continue to have these discussions about how to use the property. In our plan, we're planning to issue debt for this project in March of 2021. So when it's time to issue debt, I'll be bringing you all the information about this project, the plan, construction, how much it will cost. You'll also get a copy of a lease that's been agreed upon by Martin Marietta, the community college, and it's also been reviewed by our bond attorney and, of course, our county attorney, because there will be language in there that Martin Marietta will want, and, of course, we will want to make sure we can use borrowed money. The main thing tonight, I think, from county staff perspective is it acceptable to the commissioners? Are you comfortable with the idea of spending bond money on property that we'll lease for 50 years, $10.4 million, to construct this training center? If it is, if you feel like that's a reasonable amount of time to have access to the property, then I think what the college would like to do is move forward with your planning efforts.
That is correct. We need to engage with an architect in order to go ahead and get the project designed.
And I would say, too, I think, you know, I've attended the public meetings for the town of Green Lovell, where it was very very well supported by the town. I know we have some representation from the town here this evening. I know they have a very large interest in this coming to the town of Green Lovell. So, really, I don't think that's necessary for a vote. But if the board gives some kind of consensus that you're comfortable with these very generic terms of a lease, then we're going to proceed forward with planning to use the Martin Marietta site in Green Lovell.
Well, I have to admit that early on I was a little concerned about the shorter term nature that was under discussion. But a facility that will be built here, useful life is probably less than 50 years, maybe a maximum of 50 years. So a 50-year lease makes sense. It works with the plan, I think. And we will definitely, if we grow it, we will want to be looking at something more future. So
and there is an option after 50 years. We'll not be here, but
yeah, well, we know we will be happy to continue discussing extensions. It wouldn't be a formal option, but that was part of our conversations that involved our CEO, where he said, this is the maximum we can commit to now, but we will always be willing to discuss it.
There's a bunch of us that probably won't be here.
Yes.
I'm excluding you from that.
No.
I know you're too mean to go away.
Mrs. McCollum, would you like to come forward or be heard about it? We have Mrs. McCollum. Sandra McCollum is a councilwoman from Green Lovell.
One of them.
The back. Not yet.
Oh, all right.
No, I'm not yet.
Okay.
She was there when this started, though.
Yes.
Wow.
Carissa.
We would love to hear from you.
Okay. Thank you so much. My name is Sandra McCollum, and I'm here tonight with my husband, James Larry McCollum, and we've lived at 2546 Green Valley Boulevard, that's in Green Level, for 50 years. My husband and I have worked for the town of Green Level for many years, and we want the best that it can be. My husband was the former mayor, and I worked for the town for nearly 30 years. And I realize the board is looking for the right term agreement for Martin Marietta. And we look at 50 years, we look at this and that, but I want to say that we are in a crisis now, not 50 years, but now. I worked for Mr. J.A. Freeman in the city of Burlington school system. And he said to me, quote, Sandra, if we don't educate them now, we will pay for them later. And I'm pretty sure that we're paying for them now, because Sheriff Johnson can verify this. And it has not been 50 years when Mr. Freeman made this statement to me. So this training center would be a showcase for Green Level. Not only a showcase, but a saving center for what Mr. Freeman knows would happen in Alamance County. We all should know that everyone cannot attend a four-year college. This building will be a center that the residents in Green Level and surrounding communities can go and become the resident we want to be in our community. This will allow a man to receive a career, not a job, that he will have a reason to get up in the morning with a paycheck, with benefits, and hopefully we'll have a proud man. A single mom can have a career from this center to be able to provide for her children. She will not need any more assistance. She she hopefully will be a strong woman. This center will be a positive facility that people will be able to see, and seeing this will at least at a green level is doing their part to help our residents. This center will also help bring a restaurant, hopefully, to and other vendors that we really need in Green Level, because a little progress adds up. Let's not worry about 99 years, 50 years. Let's do what is needed today and stop worrying about tomorrow, because it's not promised. This center will not only benefit the town, but hopefully it will be a helping hand for Alamance County. So please, bring an opportunity, a dream, a chance, a hope, and a career to Green Level. Remember, there are no shortcuts to any place worth going. Thank you so much.
That was wonderful. Thank you so much. Was there anybody else from Green Level here who wanted
Carissa's
to come?
Carissa's in the back, I think. Somebody invite her to come around here. She's on the council.
Hey.
You thought you got by us, didn't
you? I already know what this is. Okay. Still. No, I really hadn't planned on speaking today. My name is Carissa Graves, and I am a council member in the town of Green Level. And yes, what Ms. McCollum said about we're anxious to see this project come forth to Green Level. It does give our community an opportunity to just do our part, be a place where people can get training. It sounds like a great idea. I'm glad we spoke up with Mr. Gatewood. I'm sorry, I'm breathing hard. Sorry, I'm sitting most pregnant. I was sitting in the back trying to get up. But anyway, but we would like to see that come to our area and hopefully show, you know, some growth in Green Level.
Great.
Okay.
Thank you.
Good luck. I think we have room in here now. You can sit right up.
Yeah, you want to sit next to
so you don't have to walk off.
Yeah. All right. Well, does anybody have any more questions about that? We have
Sherry.
For some time we have been looking at getting a training center here in Alamance County. All the fire chiefs, police chief, and head of rescue has signed on that we need a training center. The more training that our officers receive in our society today with what's happening nationwide and right here in North Carolina, training is a must for our officers, our EMS people, our fire departments, and our dispatchers and communications. And I honestly believe that as months and years pass, it's going to be more imperative that we send our officers to more training. The problem that we have is when we send them to Texas and places where the training is, it's a whole lot more expensive. With this regional training center, people will come to us and we can bring those instructors here at a whole lot less cost than sending 5, 10, or 15 officers out of state. I think it's very imperative that we look and see that this succeeds. But it's also going to be an economic impact to the town of Green Level and Alamance County. I ask you, commissioners, please stand with us on this issue and let's make it happen. Thank you.
Thank you, Sheriff.
More sales tax.
Also, I'd like to thank Martin Maria, because I have probably been a thorn in their side.
They wanted to drop a rock on you.
Yeah. Okay. Mr. Gatewood, you have, Dr. Gatewood, you have more for your presentation?
Any other questions for Kate?
Yeah. Anything else about
Martin Maria?
That part?
So, commissioners, what I'm hearing is we're going to go ahead and proceed with negotiating a lease that satisfies all three parties, and the college will proceed with planning how the training center will actually lay out on the site. And then in no short order, when it's time to issue the debt, our plan will be to bring you a proposal to issue debt for a public safety training center constructed in the town of Green Level on property owned by Martin Marietta, with, under lease terms, 50 years agreed upon by all parties.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Wonderful. Thank you very much.
Kate, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. And just to be clear, that means that we will engage in employing an architect and a general contractor or a CMA risk in order to pursue this project. Thank you. So the next item on the update is the Biotechnology Center of Excellence. So we have some changes we want to make with parking, and also we want to address the building and what we're able to achieve with the funds that we have. So I've asked our architect, Chris Brazier, with Clark Nixon, to make this part of the presentation.
Thank you, Dr. Gatewood. Madam Chair, Commissioners, thank you for the opportunity to come and share with you the work that we've been doing with the college over the course of the last several weeks. Clark Nexus is an architecture engineering firm with about 400 architects and engineers, three offices here in North Carolina. We work primarily in the science and technology and higher education. So the project, the Center of Excellence for Biotechnology, is right at the intersection, and we really are privileged to have this opportunity. And again, thank you for your time tonight to share with you where we are in the process. Do you have the...
You'll have to... I think you may have to just signal Bruce when it's time to... If you give him a high sign, advance.
So one of the things I wanted to do, we suggested to the college that we begin with a phase we call advanced planning. And the real goal of advanced planning is to understand the dollars that are available to build the project, the scope of the project, and the quality level at which we want to build. And that translates into the complexity. This project is a little bit different than a general classroom building. A biotechnology center of excellence has some pretty complex systems that are inherent in a project like that. And so one of the things that we wanted to do, and if you'll go to the next slide, is begin with the end in mind. And the end, one of the things that we understand as architects, engineers, oftentimes the dollars are fixed. So in this case, the bond provided generously $17.6 million, but that's not the dollar amount that we're going to target when we begin design work. What we want to do is to take into account the fact that the bid environment around us is a dynamic environment. There's likely to be escalation that occurs between now and when we bid the project. What we typically try and do is to shoot towards the midpoint of construction, because that's the way the construction community is going to look at pricing it. We also want to build in contingencies. We have geotechnical work that we want to do to understand the subsurface conditions on the site. There are a whole host of things, and that really is the difference between the 17.6 million that you see on the slide and the 13.7. All that to say that 13.7 number is really the number that we want to keep in mind when we're looking at alternative strategies and how we go forward. The other items that are on that slide at the bottom, looking at building and site development cost of $430 a gross square foot, and then looking at the difference between structured parking or a parking deck and what our construction manager, who is Chrisman Group, they do a lot of work here in the county, they do a lot of work for LabCorp, is telling us about what we should be planning in terms of cost per space for structured parking versus looking at parking that's on a flat surface of $5,000 a space, or on a site where we're looking at surface parking and their significant topography that we're going to encounter. So I share that with you just as context. And what I'd like to do now, if you turn to the next slide, is to look at the range of options that we've been exploring with the college. And I'll begin on the right-hand side, structured parking. And the diagram is really intended to kind of give you a really quick, high-level snapshot of the trade-off between building for the Biotechnology Center of Excellence and parking. So what you see on the right-hand side where it says COE, Center of Excellence, $6.8 million, and then parking $6.5 million, that's looking at structured parking combined with the building. And what that yields in the way of program within the building is 4 teaching labs, 2 classrooms, 1,200 square feet of common space. Now, if you were to compare that, and I won't go through all three, but if you'll compare that to B, which is right next to it, Campus Connection, and I'll share with you some drawings that kind of illustrate this. Campus Connection, if we look at surface parking on campus, and then look at surface parking at $5,000 to $6,000 a space and compare that to the structured parking, what that results in is the ability to double the number of labs and classrooms that we're able to build. So we go from 4 teaching labs, classroom labs, to 8. We go from 2 classrooms to 3. can we double the amount of common space in the building? So I'll come back to this slide once I kind of walk you through the alternative strategies, but just sort of keep this in mind. And in each case, all the options result in $13.7 million total gross maximum price that we're going to hold our construction manager to as the total dollars that are there to support the project. If we go to the next slide, please. So I mentioned that there are three alternatives that we began to take a look at. This looks at one, and please understand that this is not intended to be a final design. In advanced planning, we're at a 10,000 foot, kind of in an airplane looking down at the site, really just trying to understand the scope of the project and look at trade-offs. And so the reason this is referred to is North Face is the road that you see at the top of the drawing, the dotted outline. That is I-40, I-85, and then Carr Road is running vertically on the drawing here. I think I've got a laser pointer. If you look to the left here, it doesn't work on the screen, but you get the idea. The site for the biotechnology center is up in that top circle. And one of the goals of the college is to make the investment that the citizens of Alamance County are making with the college visible. And that intersection, the experiences thousands and thousands of cars and, moving up and down I-85. And so the idea was to place the building in a place that sort of announces the presence of the college, which is sort of concealed from all of that potential sort of future students, possibly, those that just sort of really making the college present at that intersection. And then I share with you on the lower part of the slide, the lower circle, is a surface parking lot as opposed to structured parking. And so what we're doing is taking the existing parking lot, which is immediately adjacent to that circle, and just following that existing loop road that circles around the campus and extending surface parking in that location to add capacity for the campus. So that's North Face. If we go to the next slide, this is Campus Connection. And it's a subtle difference, but what happens here is the building orients itself perpendicular to I-40, I-85. Again, one of the things that we've looked at very preliminarily is we've developed some digital models that look at, as you travel along 40 and 85, the visibility on the site. Think about it as a billboard. Billboards are located perpendicular to the line of flow. And so this looks at that orientation as a way of increasing the visibility of the building off of the interstate. But then also a really nice byproduct of this approach is that we preserve a lot of the existing parking that's already on that site. We're not displacing nearly as much as we will with the other orientation in a more north-south direction. And again, because we displace less parking in this strategy, if you look at the lower circle, we've scaled back the amount of new surface parking that's required. And again, the 13.7 number is the same number that goes back to that very first slide. And then the final strategy that I'll share with you, there are actually two variations here, one C1, one C2. This is looking at that occupying that same location in a north-south orientation. And then to the left of that, you see the little rectangular box. That's looking at structured parking immediately adjacent to the Biotechnology Center of Excellence. What we're trying to look at there is providing close proximity to the new building and also pushing the building into the hill. If you've been on campus there, there's a pretty significant hill where the grade drops from that surface parking lot up on top of the hill down. The idea being that we can sort of nestle the parking structure into the side of that hill, maybe even access it from on grade at the top and access it on grade at the bottom, thus eliminating any internal structures of ramps required to kind of navigate between the two levels. The real takeaway on this one, however, is that it displaces two existing buildings. There's two maintenance buildings that are on the site in the location of the new parking structure. And so the 0.4 million that you see on the left-hand column there replace maintenance buildings. Because we're displacing those buildings to get that structured parking in close proximity to the building, we have to make an allowance for replacing those somewhere on campus. We'll turn to C2. Very similar, except in this case, what we're able to do is preserve more of the existing surface parking that's in that upper circle, and then design a more modest structured parking scenario in the lower circle here, which we think, again, is a good location. It's immediately accessible off of that loop road, and then also from a similar kind of strategy, there's a large sloped hill that comes from the top part of the campus down to the surface parking lot adjacent to the loop road, and we would look at accessing it on grade at the lower level, and in the future potentially accessing the top surface on grade. If you go to the next slide, this really is the last slide, and I think it kind of sums up where we are. We presented to Mr. Boswell and the Building and Grounds Committee of the Trustees on the 9th, and then we presented to the trustees last Monday evening about this same time. And the desire from coming out of that meeting was to begin to really explore option B, campus connection, because it still provides for, which was the, I suggest, the initial motivation, which was to make sure that we replace any parking that we displace by putting a building on the site, and that we provide additional parking that provides parking for the increased demand that we're generating on campus by the new building. We're just not doing it in a structured format, we're doing it in surface parking. And what that does is it really allows us to dedicate much more space to the instructional environment, so those laboratories, those classrooms, those common spaces that are really kind of at the heart and the core of preparing students for those next generation jobs is provided at a much higher level, 29,000 gross square feet versus 16,000 gross square feet in the structured parking scenario. So I know that's like, fasten your seatbelt, take a really quick tour of where we've been over the last several weeks, but I'll pause, and Dr. Gatewood, if there's anything that you want to add, or Matt, I believe, is here as well, if there's anything you want to add, or General Williams.
How cost ineffective is it to go in an over-under situation where you have a garage underneath the building and so forth and so on? Does free up the land.
What's that?
It does free up the land.
Yeah. It does free up the land. That's correct.
But how cost ineffective is it to do an over-under deal?
Well, just comparing it to surface parking, it's like five times. So surface parking on a flat piece of land, 5,000 space. Structured parking, 25,000. So that's where you're seeing the translation from 16,000 gross square feet to 29,000 gross square feet, because we're generating a lot of space by just spending $5,000 per parking space versus $25,000 per parking space. Those are numbers. We're doing a project at UNC Chapel Hill that's actually north of 25,000 a space. We think that's a conservative number. It's not going to be a parking deck that's clad in anything elaborate, but it will serve the purpose. So we're trying to be reasonable in terms of the cost projections, but there is that difference between surface parking. There's also the issue of sort of any time that you have a concealed space, we're going to have to artificially illuminate that. We're going to have stairs. We're going to have elevators. Those generally want to be not sort of cave-like. They want to be open and transparent just for personal kind of safety, not being sort of going into an elevator at night and the doors closing and opening back up. But so that drives that cost up, and it creates additional kind of upkeep requirements.
Well, if you were to build a building on top of that, isn't that what you were talking about?
Yeah.
That would... The structural cost of the foundation and the garage beneath the building would be even more than what you're talking about for a structured facility, right?
Yeah, and the challenge in that is parking structures to be as efficient as possible, work off of a very regular kind of structural grid. Right. And so that would drive the grid of what happens above. So way parking work is 20-foot parking space, 20-foot drive aisle, 20-foot parking space, repeat. And ideally, you're able to arrange it in a way that you get internal circulation within each of those floors. The challenge is that creates for the building that's on top of that is if we just simply extrude it, we end up with very deep floor plates without lots of access to natural light at the perimeter. And so one of the things that, you know, we really want to try and do is make those spaces that are inside the building light and airy, and also from a transparency standpoint, making it much more safe to sort of be in those. But yeah, in certain cases, that works, where you can kind of build those two, one on top of the other. I think in this case,
you can do it. I'm just saying it's probably the structural cost of building a lot would be more.
Yes.
If you put a building on top of it, then it would stand alone.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I missed that point. Yes. And you're really trying to marry two things that don't easily want to unite.
I think one of the important things that you just mentioned is the fact that you do a structured garage. You got lights, that you got a light in there. It's a lot cheaper to go outside and put a couple poles up in quite a big field than it is to have to keep lights up under the building there. And we have to pay for that, by the way, the energy costs.
I think, again, this was on for information tonight. No vote necessary. Is there more?
I wanted to be sure again, because I'll be coming before you fairly soon. This is one of the two of the college's early projects with the recommendation to issue debt for these projects. So if I want to make sure I'm on target with the college and the board understands what's going on here and we're all on the same page. Originally, the parking deck was part of the project proposal from the college for $8,460,000. And the Center of Excellence was a project proposed to cost $9.1 million for a total of $17.6 million for a parking deck, which is the structure, and the Center of Excellence. I believe what I'm hearing the college say tonight is they would reduce the amount of money spent on parking, right, from the $8,460,000 to roughly $1.2 million, and increase the amount of money that would be spent on the Center of Excellence from a total of about $9.1 million to $12.5 million. That would allow for what I think the college is saying is equivalent number of parking spaces and a better quality Center of Excellence. And
more space for teaching and learning, absolutely.
So this is a little different than the original projects that were brought to us, but I think what's happened is the college has worked through, once the bonds were approved, analyzing what they think is the best case scenario. So what I'm listening for, again, not a vote, but I don't want to bring a proposal to the commissioners to issue debt that you don't feel comfortable with now. And I think the college needs to go ahead and move forward with some more detailed planning.
Mr. Nixon needs to know as
that's
they
right.
move forward in their planning.
So it's a change from its original structure, right, from the parking deck and Center of Excellence. This is agreeable under the bond. It's been set up to be flexible, but it still takes your approval to issue the debt. So the commissioners must feel comfortable with what the college is proposing to do.
I kind of look at the garage's storage space, and the education facility is production space. I'd a whole lot rather spend money on production space than on storage space. So
there was a lot of comments that came out of the stakeholders that are going to be involved. I wish you'd had that slide of what would the headlines say of the building the day that it's done.
I went from 30 slides to 8.
I know, but it was a really forward-looking group that are going to be in that building operating, and right. It was just amazing some of the comments they came up with, that there's going to be things in this building we haven't even thought of yet, because our world changes every day, and teaching changes every day. So it's going to be interesting just to see that going forward and getting a picture of it and seeing it come to fruition.
I should add that our Board of Trustees voted in favor of what was just presented to you at their meeting on October 14 last Monday.
Did they like Plan B the best?
Yes. Most like definitely.
Campus connection. Mm-hmm. And another thing about the parking, structured parking, I've had a little more time to think about this than y'all, but I've been in a lot of hours of meetings on it. But the thing with the building, the parking deck up there where they're talking about building, you can never build any more buildings up there should you need a building somewhere in that neighborhood to connect.
Right.
So it's been good to think through that part.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Okay, next on our agenda is the capital project ordinance for the ABSS bond project. Susan Evans is going to present that to us.
Good evening, Commissioners. Before you this evening, a project ordinance, what this will allow us to do is go ahead and budget the $150 million bond proceeds for the Alamance Burlington School System projects. This is a preliminary budget, and these numbers will change as we go through the process with our budget costs. But what this will allow us to do is go ahead and reimburse the school system per the reimbursement resolution for some preliminary expenses they've had.
And changes to this budget will come before the board. So if projects start changing, if something comes in less than these budgets and they want to reallocate or more or whatever, it will always come before the board, but this sets it up for us for it to begin.
Okay, so at the appropriate time, we would be seeking a motion to approve the ordinance that sets budgets.
Well, I'll make a motion that we approve. I'll second it.
All right, we have a motion and a second to approve that ordinance. Is there any discussion?
Is Dr. Thorpe here? I think I saw him sliding. Y'all are having a presentation with Mosley for the people, the commissioners?
For Monday.
Monday.
Stop making. Just finished the presentation for Southern. Did four today. Had pretty good turnout, a lot of good comments, but come Monday, we'll be doing one for us.
Okay.
Very good. Any more discussion? Do we have a motion?
I
made
a motion.
Do we have a second?
I think.
Thank you. So we have a motion and a second. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
Thank you.
Okay, Ms. Cattle, our planning director is going to continue to help us to understand the revisions to the heavy and proposed heavy industrial development ordinance.
I have definitely want to try. Okay, so what we have before you tonight up on the boards is the staff and subcommittee version that has went to the planning board and already gotten preliminary approval. What we're going to do tonight, and I'll read the whole thing to you because, you know, we're all capable of that. What I'm going to do is highlight the changes, which for anybody in here knows, the yellow parts to the ordinance are the parts that have been changed. So this is online. You all have it in your packets, and now we have it up on the screens. But only the yellow parts actually have changed for this version. So a couple of the whereas has changed on the front page. That's just to reflect from 2006 that we're now changing the 2011 ordinance. Let's see here. If you go over to page 3, that's our next big change. There we go. And that's where the classes have changed. You know, we went from 4 classes down to 3 classes. The subcommittee put some of what they saw as the least nuisance uses in class 1, which is fuel bulk storage, ready-mix concrete suppliers, inert debris landfills, renewable energy generating facilities, automobile salvage and storage facilities, resource extraction, metal recycling and salvage facilities. The class 2 got really small. That went to waste facilities and sawmills. Class 3 is the much bigger units, as the subcommittee saw. This is mining and quarrying, racetracks, chemical manufacturing, asphalt plants, electricity generating facilities, landfills except inert debris, paper mills, and cement manufacturing. So the subcommittee felt like those were things that needed to be shuffled around and fit better as 3 classes instead of 4. On page 4, you'll see that the area of operation has amended language where it is now including parking, stormwater erosion control measures.
Before you move on to that, can we stop and see if anybody has any questions or comments about the changing of the classes for this time? That's a lot of change.
Which of these in class 3 were class 3 before they're now class 3, including class 4?
I believe I have a version of that one.
Let's get on the right version.
You just asked me which question, and let's see.
And
I was going to throw you a curveball.
I have more in the back if we need it, so let's see. Why do I have to go get my other ordinance? I don't know that I have that version in front of me. No, let me go around the back and grab more people. You got it?
Yeah. Good planning board members, right?
They're so handy, I'm telling you. So, Class 3 used to be just waste facilities, chip mills, and racetracks. Chip mills are now into two categories. They are the sawmills and paper mills. So that got split up into Class 2 and 3.
What was in Class 4 in the old
one? So Class 4 in the old one was hard mining, resource extracting, quarrying, asphalt plants, fossil fuel generating facilities, landfills except inert debris, cement manufacturing, metal recycling, and salvage facilities.
So the only addition here then is the paper mill, is that right?
Right, so the paper mill used to be a Class 3 chip mill, and that's been broken into two different categories at this point.
Those paper mills are really stinkers.
They do have a smell, yes.
Probably been about one for a couple of years, I guarantee that.
Is Alamance County considered a good location to put a paper mill?
Because I don't think so. No.
I'd always seen them down at the coast or like Savannah River or the Wando River.
I think it takes a lot of water maybe to operate on these
kinds of water.
Let's go if we don't really expect to see that happen. But we're here to protect everything we can think of.
Right.
You can't always cover that, but we're going to protect what we know. Okay. Are we ready? Okay. So page 4, the area of operation, it has been expanded to include parking, stormwater control measures, and other uses necessary for the business of the industry. Area of operation shall not include required setbacks or those areas required by this ordinance or any other regulations to be kept in vegetative state. So we're just protecting the buffers and giving just a little more clarity to the area of operation. Page 5, electricity generating facilities. That includes any standalone plant not ancillary to another land use, which is intended for the commercial generation of electric power, for any source other than solar, hydroelectric, and wind, including but not limited to fossil fuels, nuclear, or waste products, to be primarily distributed to the public for compensation. Definition shall not apply to agricultural farm, residence, business, or other facility where the sale of electricity so produced is secondary to its consumption. So this kind of broke out and separated from renewable energy facility, which has a new definition on page 7. That's really your solar farms. The way they produce energy is very different, so the subcommittee decided to break out these definitions and make them look different, just so they seem different when you see them online. And you'll see also on page 7, that's where the paper mill definition comes in. And it comprises establishments primarily engaged in manufacturing paper from pulp. These establishments may manufacture or purchase pulp. In addition, the establishments may convert the paper they make. The activity of making paper classifies an establishment into this industry, regardless of the output. So that there's a book that Clyde's office has and I have that gives these definitions of industries. It's really nice and thick and about a 2 font. So that's where most of these definitions come from, so we're using about a 2 font. So we're using language that's common to the industry, not just our. So y'all stop me anytime, but I'm gonna keep rolling until you tell me to stop. Page 8, you get that sawmill definition. Means any permanent commercial establishment is primarily engaged in sawing dimension lumber, boards, beams, timbers, poles, ties, shingles, shakes, siding, and wood chips from logs or bolts. Sawmills may plane the rough lumber that they make with a planing machine or achieves smoothness and uniformity of size.
Did you want to talk about resource extraction? You missed that one.
Did I skip that one?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Sorry, resource extraction. This is going to be more similar to what we used to call soft mining. And so we broke that apart and kind of give it a new definition. Resource destruction means commercial removal of any naturally occurring substance from the land not otherwise covered by the definition of mining and quarrying. Such substances include, but not limited to, topsoil or field dirt. Such substances do not include petroleum in any form, natural gas, or other gaseous substances, agricultural products, timber, surface, subsurface, water, or any renewable resource. So these, there's a couple of those already in the county. They were kind of there before the ordinances came about, but we have a couple examples of those. So on page 8 is the sawmill. We just went through that. Like I said, we took that chip mill and broke it into paper and saw, because it kind of operate a little bit differently and look a little bit different for nuisance purposes. They smell a little bit different. Section 4 on page 8, prior to the issuance of any permit under this ordinance, the regulated land use must demonstrate compliance with the regulations and standards imposed by this section. We're just cleaning up some language, making it very clear, a little less vague to the other ordinance. Also, you'll see land spacing in this chart has changed. Class 1 there didn't look to do any land spacing. Class 2 is 150 feet land spacing. Class 3 is 1,200 feet. And remember that land spacing, you'll see it later on, but in the new ordinance, land spacing is being proposed from property lines, not from center of operation. A under that is minimum lot size. No Class 1 or Class 2 land use regulated by this ordinance shall be situated on a tract of land less than 10 acres in size. Class 3 land use shall be located on a tract of land no less than 40 acres in size. And that's just repeating, but it's given the minimum lot size definition. And these are the things that we saw that maybe needed some clarity from the old ordinance. Page 9, land use spacing protected facilities. Land use spacing shall be measured in a straight line without regard for intervening structures or objects from the closest edge of the property line of the tract in which the area of operations is located to the nearest improvement currently in use as a protected facility. That's a big change because we're not measured from the middle anymore. The list of protected facilities didn't change except for number 9, and we included historic landmarks recognized by the Alamance County Historic Properties Commission. That was something that was brought up in some of the public comment for the Alamance Court. Operation setback, all industries regulated by this ordinance shall be required to designate and maintain a minimum operation setback. That's in quotes because we have a definition of that. Operation setback shall be measured from the edge of the designated area of operations to the property line of the tract in which the operation is located. No area of operations or roads may be may be located within the operation setback area. Vegetative screening and fencing are allowed. That was something that was questioned. The vegetative and fencing said we want to make sure we were clear on what would be allowed in that setback. Letter E is traffic impact analysis. Not going to read this one all the way to you, but one of the big parts is access to all regulated industries shall be directly from a state-maintained road. During this process, we had an inquiry on a possible industry to come in on a private road, and we thought that is certainly not something that we want to have to deal with. We're going to make sure we cover that in the new ordinance. So they've got to come off a state-maintained road. These are paved roads, you know, a little bit wider. They're just better maintained than a private road would be. At the end of that, we put in there the requirement of a traffic impact analysis should it be needed. And it says all industries regulated by this ordinance shall be required to demonstrate if their proposed heavy industrial use would create an amount of traffic in terms of vehicle trips per day that would push the roads by which the industry is gaining access over its practical carrying capacity as defined by NCDOT, the most updated version of the Institute of Transportation Engineers Trip Generation Manual, shall be used to determine the average number of daily trips generated by the proposed industry. The regulated industry shall add these projected daily vehicle trips to the most recent traffic counts per NCDOT. So this is going to be a partnership with DOT. They have the traffic engineers. They call for TIAs often on large projects anyway. So this is kind of pulling them into the process to see what's needed from a traffic perspective. That's something we haven't had before. I know there was some discussion with the current quarry on what that looked like, so this will pull them in to help us.
That's a good addition.
Oh, yeah, I think so. Good addition. That probably would have given us a better look at what's going on with the traffic coming out of that.
No, DOT has evaluated the current quarry, but it's under their standards and everything. F on page 10 is operations area. Operation of the regulated land use outside of the designated area of operations is prohibited. The following areas shall not be allowed in the designated area of operation of a regulated industry. Any area located within a special flood hazard area, we didn't have that before. Any area classified as wetlands, woody swamp, or by the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, we also did not have that. Any area designated by North Carolina Wildlife Commission as habitat for as an identified species of greatest conservation need. So those change. Those are kind of moving around with the Wildlife Commission on a regular basis. So we keep our, one of our offices or their offices is local and Meadow. So they're kind of easy to keep up with. And anytime we have a project, you can send that project over to them. They'll do a full review and give you their take on what's going on with them and how that project would affect them. So we wanted to include them. Another important part of this is co-location of other land uses regulated by this ordinance within the area designated for operation of the regulated industry is not allowed. Each land use is required by this ordinance to designate an area of operation must maintain a separate and distinct operations area. So you can't have a mine come in and then say, oh, no, we want to do an asphalt plant too, and we're going to do it all in the same place. No, they're going to have to come in as separate permits. They're all going to be designated as separate areas on a piece of property or multiple pieces of property, however they want to do it. This is not something that was covered in the old ordinance, but it, during discussions with the subcommittee and with the planning board, it kind of came up, so we're like, well, we need to protect that as well and make sure we keep these distinct. Okay. H, landscaping and screening. All industries regulated by this ordinance shall be required to provide landscaping and screening. What's changed here is class 1 and 2 are treated the same as what we've been treating. Class 3 has now a 100-foot landscaping buffer with a 3-layer tree approach, whereas class 1 and 2 is a 2-layer approach with 50-foot landscaping buffer. And it has a lot to say on that. All the, I guess, the visuals of that is in Appendix A. Gating and fencing, this is also something we didn't really cover in the old ordinance. At a minimum, the area of operation of regulated use shall be completely enclosed by a minimum 6-foot high fence with self-locking gate. Now, so you know, we don't have any problems with people accidentally leaving gate open or anything. And when it means at a minimum, the discussion of that became, well, do they want to fence all the land that they own? Do they only want to fence the part they're operating? What part should we include? So we know for their purposes, they're going to be required to do a fence anyway. But from our perspective, just at a very minimum, you're going to fence in the part that is the most disturbing to keep people from trespassing and keep back and forth anything coming out as well. So that's why that, at a minimum, is in there. K is compliance with other government requirements, bless you. Applicants under this ordinance are required, that's a change, to comply with all other applicable county, state, and federal regulations. Let's see what that says. I think we broke that apart before, because it was not required at that stage before. I think we actually had that in a different part of the ordinance is what part of what we were doing too. And the other addition there is failure to submit any additional information required by the planning director shall result in the denial or revocation of an operations permit. That we don't have right now, so we'll put a little stronger language on that. This stuff is just not suggested, this is required at this point. So that should be all page 11. Page 12, we didn't make any changes to. Page 13, under pre-application meeting required, that wasn't required before. The applicant and or an authorized corporate officer is required to meet in person with planning staff, a planning staff member, to discuss the nature of their application at least 14 days prior to a formal application submitting the site plan. So it gives us 2 weeks to talk to somebody, give them what they're required to do, us know what's going on, and kind of let it be known that we're talking to somebody about these things. At the pre-application meeting, the applicant shall identify in writing. Yes, sir.
Does this mean at that point in time we would get a notice that something was good and ready?
Right. I'd send it up the chain. Send it to Brian and Sherry, and they'd let them all know what's going on. And depending on how much information, we're asking for quite a bit of information at pre-application meeting, but we'll see exactly how much more detail they will give. But at least we'll get a general idea of location and what it is and how big it is,
right,
which is three of the big things we're looking at, right? So at the pre-application meeting, the applicant shall identify in writing any additional permits which the applicant needs in order to operate the regulated industry and provide a reasonable timeline for obtaining those permits. Additionally, the applicant shall identify any protected facilities in the spacing area for which a spacing waiver is required. So we're kind of getting some of the big questions up front. And by putting those requirements to give us a list of all their permits, when we get into that, it's been a year, what's going on, they should have already told us what timeframes we're looking for. And if those things have expired, then we go back to the drawing board and say, well, we can revoke the permit at this point because this is what you told us, but it's not working out that way. So it gives us a little more ability down the road a little bit. The intent to construct permits, that's a bit of a change. Just in the first paragraph, an intent to construct industrial development permit is required for each regulated use. Back to you can't put asphalt plant and mining on the same piece without having separate applications. The public hearing notice, this is giving you things that have never been in the ordinance, never really even considered. Our current ordinance allows for notification to be put on our GIS server. And that's all that we've done in the past. So the onus is put back on the applicant in this part. The applicant shall cause notice of public hearing to be published in the newspaper. Part of this language is really state law. No less than 10 days, not more than 25 days before the date fixed for hearing. The applicant shall cause notice to be mailed, emailed, or delivered to each newspaper, wire service, radio station, and television station that has filed a written request for notice. This list may be obtained from our board. The applicant shall prominently post a notice of public hearing on the site proposed for the issuance of the intent to construct permit in the adjacent public street or highway right-of-way. So if we had zoning and someone were to go through and ask for a rezoning, the jurisdiction is responsible for placing some type of sign on property, and it varies. There's no real legal way that you have to do it, but you have to place a sign on to get a physical notice as people drive by that something's going on there. You put the local jurisdiction, the phone number, whatever information you want to provide.
A yellow sign with black writing on it, right?
That's a good example.
City of Burlington, yeah.
Cities do it. Like I said, you can print the sign, the cover, there's some basics you have to cover, really just what it is and, you know, that it's at that jurisdiction and who to call. This is kind of getting to something similar to that. They're responsible for posting that property, not us. But they have to prove to us that they posted it. Usually it's take a picture, tell us what date it was posted kind of thing. Let's see here. The applicant shall cause to be mailed a notice of public hearing by first class mail at the last addresses listed on the Alamance County tax abstract for owners of all parcels of land abutting that parcel of land as shown on the county tax listing. So anything that touches it. The owners of all parcels of land as shown on county tax, any portion of which is located within the spacing requirement. The resident of any residential structure located on the parcels listed above, meaning if this is rural property or something, the renter should get notice as well. The holder of any utility or other easement on the parcel included in the application. And the notice of public hearing shall be mailed by the applicant to those property owners or residents identified above at least 21 days prior to public hearing. And that information is in the appendices of what we're including in notices. The applicant shall produce a list showing all names and addresses to whom notice of public hearing was mailed and shall certify the proper notice was given to all required persons or organizations. Improper notice or certification shall be grounds to deny the intent to construct permit. So they give that to us. I won't say we verify for them, but we validate that this makes sense and that they've done what they were supposed to. C says the planning board shall hold a public hearing on the application for the intent to construct permit. At this public hearing, the regulated industry and community members may comment on the application. So this just gives everybody the opportunity to have their say and know about it in advance. That's a lot.
I could get you back up to number three.
Okay.
When I was reading this, it kind of caught my attention that it looks like it might leave it up to the discretion of the applicant. Decide how many notices to provide?
Post sufficient notice to provide reasonable notice. That's coming out of straight state law for zoning. So we can clean that language up if we want to. That's just kind of how it's written already.
I mean, we've already had a problem with one industry that didn't really want to let everybody know what they were doing in the first place.
Okay.
I kind of think that's like, I don't know, I can't come up with a good comparison, but I'd like for us to have some language in there that really says, determines some minimum level of notification that's higher than leaving at the discretion of the applicant. Right? Somebody can be a couple hundred acres inside five was enough, and by this ordinance, we couldn't say he was wrong, it doesn't look like.
For the posting part, right.
Right.
What's your thoughts on that?
I don't know. It depends on the street frontages and everything, too. It's a lot of players in three sentences.
Well, that was my concern. It's so vague. You don't know what's about.
I don't think we need to leave it to the person that's going in there.
You can look at it two ways. It's vague enough where they can do what they want to, but then it's vague enough for us to say, no, you have three frontages, and we really believe that multiple means you need them.
Well, then maybe it needs to say, at the approval of the planning board.
Planning board?
Planning department.
Okay.
I think that's so good. That's a good addition. Yeah.
Okay. We'll massage that a little bit. That was a lot said. Is there anything else?
Well, there was also the language in here that didn't specifically identify the type of mailing, I don't believe.
It was first class mail, I believe, is what it said.
Right, first class. Amy and I talked about that earlier today. That sounds, once again, how do you know they mail it?
Well, they're giving us the list and certifying when they sent it.
Right.
That's our proof.
And if you had a question, you could go behind them and verify that person received that. Correct.
Right. They're not responsible for what the post office does. They're responsible for getting it in the mailbox. So that's the part we're asking for. Because actually getting to their house is not technically their responsibility.
That's what I was saying. Certified mail, right?
This is something that's been played with back and forth. So certified or first class or what is the most appropriate. So yes, that discussion has happened to get to that point, but it was back and forth.
I think you need to be certified.
Could you say that the owners of all the parcels of land abutting that parcel of land that's where the next door neighbors, maybe they should get certified, and then others that are within the spacing limit, maybe they get first class. But it seems like if you ride next door to somebody who's applying for a heavy industrial permit, that it'd be nice if you got a certified letter. So
and that obligates them to go pick it up.
Yeah, so people, if you get a certified letter, go get it. If you get a certified letter,
it is on you to go pick it up. That's absolutely right. If you want to know what's in that letter, you got to go pick it up.
Well, your signs are going to be a notification to the people that live next to it.
That's right.
To a certain degree.
You know, unless it's on a dead-end road and nobody goes past it.
Yeah.
Small chance that could happen.
That does happen.
Mm-hmm. There's a thousand different ways you can.
But possibly certified would be a better way of delivering that.
So we just want to do certified to the abutting parcels?
I was going to say, I know we probably can't protect against every instance, but as many as we can.
Okay.
Yeah. Connect the people next to this need to really know, and that would be one way to do that to make sure they got it.
Okay.
And that puts the burden of proof back on the applicant.
Right, they have to give us a copy of everything.
If there's a question or whatever by a person. Well, I didn't know about it. Well, you can
that always happens.
Find the applicant, tell the applicant, be sure to hold your receipts when you get them back.
We need a copy of them.
Yeah.
So we'll do just the abutting owners, is that what we're looking for? Okay. Are we ready to move to number three? Okay. Approval of intent to construct permit application. Letter B, the planning department shall review the site plan based on compliance with the regulations imposed by this ordinance. After this review, the planning department will establish that the intent to construct application is complete and ready for public hearing and review. So there's a time frame in here of how long we have to do this, which is a 30 days. So before we authorize this to go to a planning board, we do a review to make sure this is actually a complete submittal. And if it's not, we kick it back. If they don't have everything we need, we say it's incomplete, denied, and turn back to them. C, completed applications shall be presented to the planning board for a public hearing and determination of compliance with the requirements of this ordinance. If the planning board determines that the applicant is compliant with the requirements of this ordinance, the planning board shall forward its approval recommendation to the Board of Commissioners for final approval. If the planning board determines that the application is not compliant with the requirements of this ordinance, the planning board shall issue a written determination of its reasons and deny the application.
Hold up. I'm looking at the staff drafted version, and I'm looking at the planning board drafted version. And it looks like to me that the staff drafted version said the planning, under 3C, the planning department shall review the site plan and documentation and make a recommendation of approval or denial. Is that in the, is that step in the...
You said the planning department make a recommendation of approval or denial?
Yeah.
Well, we're reviewing it first to say it is in compliance.
Yeah, under the planning board, the subcommittee's version, it says the planning department will establish that the application is complete and ready for a public hearing and review, and then the completed application is presented to the planning board for a public hearing and determination of compliance. And so is this skipping the step of the planning director reviewing the application and determining whether it should be approved or denied?
Well, it says the planning department shall review the site plan based on compliance with the regulations imposed by this ordinance. That gives the planning department reasonable, I guess, time to say yes, it's in compliance, or no, it's not, and I'm ready to send it forward, or I don't think there's enough here to send it forward.
You have evaluated it at that point.
And after the planning department established the intent to construct an application is complete, and that's the part of us reviewing before we ever hit a board, and ready for public hearing and review.
So you're saying that by the planning department presenting it to the planning board for a public hearing, that is sort of de facto saying that it's making a recommendation for approval? Because if it wasn't complete, then you would not be submitting it for approval?
Right. At the review, if it's not complete, I'm going to deny and send back for whatever I'm missing.
I think based on compliance says that, really. It's saying that they've met all the stipulations, what I'm reading.
Is that?
Okay.
I'm reading the thing that was given to us the last meeting that we had. Okay. We should have encouraged everybody to bring the staff draft. Mr. Albright, one of the things about our planning board is that it's advisory and not actually exercising the sovereign power. If they are given, does that change if the planning board is reviewing applications that have been completed but not de facto approved?
I think as it's written, as Ms. Cattle has just presented it, the planning department reviews it, and the planning board sets it for a public hearing and determines its compliance with the ordinance.
She's checked all the boxes, basically.
Then it goes to the Board of County Commissioners for final approval. It's an advisory function.
Okay, so it's still advisory. Okay, thank you for confirming that.
Okay. In cases where the planning board recommends approval of an application, the board of commissioners shall review the recommendation of the planning board and review the application for compliance with the requirements of this ordinance. If the board of commissioners determines that the application is compliant with the requirements of this ordinance, it shall issue the intent to construct permit. So the board of commissioners actually issues the permit.
Okay. I'll just go ahead and go on the record as saying that I do not favor that. All of the things, every solar farm, everything in the county where everybody applies for a permit under this ordinance has to come into this meeting room, because we've only got so much time. We have a planning board that is available, and my personal opinion is that it's sufficient for the planning board to, my personal preference would be that the planning director makes a recommendation to approve or deny, then the planning board has a public hearing and makes a recommendation to, or approves or denies it. And then if you have one says yes and one says no, like the planning director says yes and the planning board says no, then there's a right of appeal to the Board of Commissioners so that you have that final say.
So in the current version, it goes from if the director denies it, they can appeal it to the Board of Commissioners. So something similar, but you've got an extra step in it.
Right. But I think that if the planning director agrees that it should be approved and the planning board agrees that it should be approved,
then it shouldn't have to go to,
I don't think that it should have to come to the Board of Commissioners.
That leads me back to your advisory question. As the planning board bylaws are written, I don't know.
Well, it's still ministerial because they're going, and we talked about this more than once, is still ministerial because they're going through a checklist and making sure that the requirements of the ordinance have been met. Either they've been met or they're not, and it's ministerial. And it's not really any different from what the planning board does now with reviewing, like we call them, cell phone towers and stuff.
I guess my question would be is how many of these requests have we had in the last 2 years for things that are in this ordinance that are really going to be covered?
Best of my knowledge, what I've seen, I think we had less four, maybe six altogether since 2017.
So you really, it's not going to be, I don't think it would be a...
I don't see them at every meeting, no.
No, I wouldn't see that either. It's
before a year. You know, how many are in the pipeline now?
Well, I think this is 17, so 17 and 18. In the pipeline now, I'm probably discussing maybe a half dozen people of different types.
They come up, you have to go ahead and do them. You can't put them off, right? So we're going to have the budget public hearing in May. We're voting on the budget in June and have to take time to deal with.
Maybe we don't want to get in the same situation we're in today.
Well, that's true. I don't think that we want to get it in the same situation as today, but I think that there's enough with having a public hearing at the planning board level, and there's transparency. If people have met the requirements of the ordinance, that they've met the requirements of the ordinance. And I don't see like a three-level review is going to really prevent anything.
Have we compared the language in this to the language in the surrounding counties in their ordinance?
Well, there's a problem with that because they all have zoning. So they go for rezoning, they go for a special use permit, they go for conditional zoning.
And those go before their council.
Yeah, all the zoning stuff goes before council.
They do. It's not unusual.
No.
That
no.
Two or three on a agenda at Burlington.
Well, I've served on the Burlington City Council, and I don't want to get to be zoning bland.
That's kind of what we're doing, though, in a way.
Yeah, that's,
you need to say go willy-nilly and have what you want in the county or do something and make wise decisions.
Like you said, we don't want to be where we are, right?
I think that maybe what I understand you saying is that you don't want to be the...
I don't want to hear everything that comes through.
Yeah, they have, like, it's not the Board of Equalization and Review, it's their Board of Adjustments or something. That's through...
We have one, it just hasn't met.
Right, I mean, I'm saying that the municipalities that have zoning, they have a separate board that does those reviews, where the City Council doesn't have to do that.
No, a lot of time they'll bring their zoning to the council
and they make
with recommendation. The planning board said yes, we agree or not.
Yeah, zoning's probably going to the council, but especially use permit or something might land at
that point. Pretty much a
rubber stamp.
It's everybody.
But it puts it out in the
Anyway, that's just my opinion about that little part, and we can, you know, we got a couple weeks to think about it.
Okay, and letter E, planning staff should take no longer than 30 days. Should there be holidays or, you know, hurricanes or something crazy, that doesn't say shall, it says should for that purpose. If there needs to be 31 days or 32 days, then that's okay to review the application package. Four is appeal of denied application, and this is going to depend on who makes that decision as to how this appeal goes. But as it's written, within 30 days of issuance of the written denial determination by the planning board, the applicant or planning director may appeal the decision of the planning board to the Board of Commissioners, who shall review the written determination of the planning board and review the applicant application for compliance with the requirements of the ordinance. If the Board of Commissioners determines that the application is compliant with the requirements of this ordinance, it shall issue the intent to construct permit. If the Board of Commissioners determines that the application is not compliant with the requirements of this ordinance, it shall deny the application. The decision of the Board of Commissioners may be appealed for Article 6 of this ordinance. And that goes through kind of the legal jargon of what happens after a decision is made. That will depend on Section 3 of what y'all do with that. But it gives them a specific time frame of how long they have to take action.
The planning board is advisory. Can it issue a determination?
That it's going to make a recommendation, yeah. And if they deny it, then they give a reason for, and then there's that opportunity for appeal.
They can appeal.
I'm just thinking about that language. That sounds more like an approval board than it does like an advisory board. issuance of the written denial by the planning board?
Well, that was part of what it said back here, that the planning board has to give written reason why they deny something, so that's that language is going over. And the denial of approval or denial of recommendation really is all it is.
Mr. Albright?
Yes, sir. Usually the way it's done is recommendation to approve it or recommendation to deny it, and then they list the reasons why they want to deny it. And the applicant will bring it before the board, and the board may uphold the plan, at which time the applicant goes to Superior Court and gets a judge to look at it and make sure that they comply with the court. That's the way it's set up in this draft.
And we could put written recommendation of denial if that.
I think that
might
flows more with what you're saying the responsibilities are.
A couple words to throw that one up. All right, for number five, duration of intent to construct permit. Intent to construct permit shall be valid for 1 year from the date of issuance. That's not a change. Delays due to those permitting requirements previously identified in the pre-application meeting shall not be grounds for permit expiration. Expired permits due to inactivity shall require reapplication and review. In the event that an applicant must reapply for a permit, it shall require a fee to be paid at the time of filing of the application, because it's considered an application again. If prior to issuance of the operation industrial permit, any changes or amendments are made to an approved site plan which impacts the requirements of this ordinance, the changes or amendments must be submitted to the planning director for approval. In the event an application is resubmitted with substantial impacts, the planning director may require an additional public hearing and reapproval of the application.
So my version here said planning department versus
department. I'm sorry.
Okay.
One line's department, one finance director. So this just gives some opportunity if things slide around. How significant is it? If the driveway moves 5 foot, probably not a big deal, but you move it to the other side of the property, we've got to change. Those kind of things, leave it to the discretion of the director so the boards don't see every little thing. Section 5, operations permits. A valid operations industrial development permit shall be required before the owner or operator of the regulated land use commences, continues, or maintains operations of said land use. An operations industrial development permit is required for each regulated use. A does not change. B, operations permits may be approved prior to the completion of required traffic improvements upon the guarantee of said improvements by the owner or operator within an 18-month period. The County of Alamance may accept surety bond issued by any company authorized to do business in the state, a letter of credit issued by a financial institution licensed to do business in the state, or another form of guarantee that provides equivalent security in surety bond or letter of credit. All surety instruments shall be made payable to Alamance County. Surety must be in an amount equal to 1.5 times 150% the cost of making the improvements, whereby such improvements may be made without cost to the public or subsequent purchases of property in the event of default on the part of the owner. So that's pretty common even in our subdivision ordinance, that if you can't get it done but you need it approved, you put the money up so that we can do it should you fail to. So that's just kind of pulling from some of our other ordinances. And 125 to 150% is pretty common because the cost of doing these things changes and we're holding for a certain amount of time, so that cost could go up. So three, other requirements. A is already there, but B, proof that all required permits from other governmental or regulatory agencies have been issued. This is for the operations permit. The operations permit must be displayed in a conspicuous place where it may be readily observed by the public upon entering the main business structure of the regulated use if the business is open to public. Like a solar farm and stuff, they're not really open to public, so we wanted to make it work, make a little bit of sense depending on which use you're looking at. Number four, appeal of denied operations permit. In the event the operations permit is denied, the applicant may appeal the planning department's decision to the board of commissioners pursuant to Article 6. So that's a little bit of a change there too. Section 6, operations permit renewal required. Operations permits issued under this ordinance are valid for a period of 2 years and shall automatically expire unless renewed. An operations industrial development permit renewal is required for each regulated use. A little bit of a change from what we did have. And number two under that is, it is the responsibility of the permit holder to schedule a site visit with the Alamance County Planning Department. So it puts the onus back on them to make sure they keep their permits updated. Number three, letter B, proof of continued compliance with all requirements of this ordinance and maintenance of all required permits. If the permitted location has been the subject of two or more enforcement actions within the renewal period, then the planning director, at their discretion, may require a public hearing before the Alamance County Planning Board prior to the renewal of the operations permit. So if we've had a problem child, they don't necessarily get their permit. Thank you.
That's a good idea.
That hasn't been there before, but we have had a good example, but we don't really want one, so that's what we're going to leave it at. Number four, appeal of denial of an operations permit. In the event that an operations permit renewal is denied, the applicant may appeal the planning department's decision to the Board of Commissioners pursuant to Article 6. So everybody gets to appeal anything all the way up. And this is just giving them language for that. Y'all are nearing the end, by the way. So page 18 is that Article 6 appeals. If an individual has been cited for a violation of this ordinance or has had a permit denied or revoked by the planning department, they may appeal the planning department's decision to the Board of Commissioners. Appeals must be submitted in writing within 13 days of notice of violation or notice of denial or revocation. At that time, the applicant's appeal will be placed on the next available planning board agenda. That does not mean the very next one. Then that kind of leaves it up to the chair. If there's other business, it can be slid around. So for the planning board to review, the planning board will then make a recommendation to uphold or overturn the planning department's decision to the Alamance County Board of Commissioners. The Board of Commissioners shall make the final determination to uphold or overturn the planning board's decision, or planning department's decision, excuse me. And number two, within 30 days of receiving notice, every decision of the planning board or Board of Commissioners shall be subject to review of Superior Court in nature. This is straight general statute information of what time frame, and then we're just putting it in the ordinance. So that's a lot said. Does anybody want anything on those? At this point, we're going to move into Article 7, which is spacing waivers and variances. So spacing waivers, as they currently are, anybody that has a structure that's within that spacing waiver that the current applicant can't meet the requirements of the waiver, that person that owns the property can sign away and send us the copy and notarize and all that and allow the operation to continue. That's how the Alamance Quarry was done, and it's by ordinance in our current ordinance. The subcommittee wanted to make a change to that. It says, in the event a regulated industry cannot satisfy the land use spacing requirements due to the presence of a protected facility, the regulated industry may apply for a waiver of the requirement. The waiver may be granted, but is not required to be granted, in the discretion of the Board of Commissioners. If the owner's end fee of the parcel on which the protected facility exists consents in writing to the operation of the regulated use and the regulated industry is otherwise compliant with all requirements of the ordinance. So they gotta be compliant with everything else in the ordinance. They just have this one person that they've got an issue with the protective facility, and that they say it's good, but they have to come to you all, and you all have to say it's good before it's really good.
And that was in the staff draft too?
Yes, that was something that was probably in every draft, somewhere or another, because that was seen as something big that allowed this operation to happen that could be fixed pretty easily. And it's looked at more of a community impact rather than individual impact that the other ordinance was looking at more closely. Okay, I'm going to tell you page appendix A has the landscaping changes. Screen buffer shall be a minimum.
Before you go there, page 21, effective date.
Oh.
It's not 2012. It should be December 3rd, 2019.
And Ben had that on there for a reason, but he didn't want to change that date for ones that came in under the old ordinance. There was a reason he left that on there, because then he put adopted this day of 2019.
We'll talk to
him
about that.
Okay, that was on purpose. That
caught,
wouldn't miss.
That caught my eye. Hold on, one question.
We'll make whatever changes.
7 years?
Yeah. We'll make whatever changes needed. But he purposely did it like that.
Okay.
But you'll see the landscaping change that we talked about, the 50-foot and 100-foot is actually shown visually. And then under suggestive vegetation, there was language added. Native species are preferred. Plantings which could be considered invasive are strongly discouraged. You know, they survive better if they're native. So it keeps them in compliance. Other than the fee schedule changed because we changed classes, and then the public hearing part, public notice, sorry, changed. And that was pretty much it for this version. And that's a lot said, and I don't know how long it took, but
you're a fast talker.
I could talk faster, but I tried to slow down.
Speed reader and fast talker, right?
Well, I told y'all stop me from being too.
A lot of people worked really hard on this for quite a long time, better part of a year. And
thank you for all your time.
Oh, absolutely.
Yes.
These guys gave all their time. They came weekly and happy or not, or rain or not, they're in there trying to get it done.
That's a round of applause.
Yeah.
Really. Check will be in the mail, guys.
And okay. We're going to have the next thing on our agenda is to set a public hearing. So we'll have a public hearing on the proposed new ordinance, and then we'll have an opportunity to discuss it more before we vote on it.
Right. As the request is written, we're looking to do that in the November 4th meeting tonight.
I would make a motion that we do that.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to set a public hearing on the revised heavy industrial development ordinance for November the 4th at 9 o'clock in the morning. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right, before we move on to our next item, does anybody want to take a break? It's been 2 hours. All right, so we'll be in recess. All right, if we could come back to order, please. We still have more business to do. Next on our agenda is the quarter cent sales tax. Mr. Hagan.
Thank you very much. Good evening, commissioners. You do have two items on your agenda that are related to each other. The first item is your consideration of putting the Article 46 sales tax on the ballot, specifically for March of 2020. The second item is involving the possibility of how you would spend the revenue if it does pass, if you would be put it on the ballot and if it passed. So I'm going to talk about both. They are two separate items, take two separate votes, but I'm going to talk about them in tandem as we go through this presentation. So you have a copy of the presentation. And first of all, just a recap. We talked about this the last time we met. But just for everyone's refresher, Article 46 is a sales tax option available to the county. It's a 0.25%. A new Article 46 sales tax would apply to everything that's currently being taxed already by Articles 39, 40 and 42. So the exceptions would be unprepared foods, right? So the Article 46 won't apply to groceries or bundled transactions, which are transactions where I believe it's 10% of the price is unprepared food. So there is a part of the statute that specifically talks about bundled transactions, and there are certain building materials that would not be applicable to this tax. I have copies of the statute tonight for Article 46 and for what is specifically exempt. There are a lot of exemptions for sales tax in the state of North Carolina. A lot of agricultural uses are exempt for sales tax. So it has to be something that's already being taxed by the other articles that are in place.
That doesn't apply to gas either, right?
That's correct. It does not apply to fuel.
What about medicine?
There are certain medicines and medical devices, I think I read today that prosthetics are not subject to this. So it's spelled out in much detail in the statute. And as I say, I do have copies of the statute here, and I can provide them to you. But again, suffice it to say, it wouldn't be taxing anything new. The things that are exempt would be exempt with Article 46 also. 46 is an optional sales tax for the county. The commissioners have the ability to dedicate the revenue for any public purpose. You're not under any obligation to use it for any specific thing. You have the ability to dedicate the revenue for any public purpose, but it does require voter approval to enact. And the ballot language is determined by the state, and you have a copy of a resolution in your packet that actually shows what language will be on the ballot. And it's very sparse. As I said last time, well, we met, the state made a recent change where the county can only attempt this one time a year. So if the commissioners decide tonight to put this measure on the ballot for March and it fails, the next time we would be eligible would be November, because it has to be a countywide ballot, but you would not be able to put it on the ballot in November if it fails in March. And the commissioners can designate the use of the revenue that would come from Article 46. That's really the second item on the agenda, is a resolution where you would be telling the public, this is what we plan. If you vote for this measure, this is what we plan to do with. But you can't put that on the ballot. So you can't have the ballot say you're going to use this for education. There was actually a measure at the state level to allow the counties to be able to do that, but it didn't get out of committee. So I think it passed the House.
It kind of be up to these guys to help make sure that got out to the public, right?
I think there was some consideration that if the public at the time they voted could actually read on the ballot what the commissioners had said they would do with the revenue, it might help the voter make a better decision about whether to vote yes or no. So Article 46, I want to talk to you a little bit about the amount of revenue we project. If you'll remember back when we were talking about the bond projects, we estimated that on an Article 46 measure would create approximately $4.8 million every year. We came up with that figure based on fiscal year 16-17 Article 42 revenues, looking at eight counties that have Article 46 and Article 42 and averaged, and came up with $4.8 million. We've since learned that the Association of County Commissioners puts this information on their website. We looked at the Association of County Commissioners. So many counties are considering Article 46 now. The Association tries to help counties at least understand how much revenue it might create. The Association of County Commissioners used fiscal year 16-17 and 17-18 sales tax data from Article 39, and they estimate for Alamance County $6,205,774 would be what an Article 46 would create here. We looked at our own data for fiscal year 16-17, 17-18, and 18-19, same numbers that the same source that the association is looking at, Article 39, and we came up with $6,229,957. So I feel like telling you this evening that it is reasonable to expect an Article 46 sales tax measure in Alamance County would create approximately $6.2 million on an annual basis. So that's the figure that we are using going forward in our planning that I'll be talking about.
That's about 4.4 cents off of property tax, right?
I think, yes, that's very close. Property tax dollar amount that we're using is a little over $1.4 million. So what would I suggest to the commissioners? Now, again, please remember the commissioners have the ability to use this revenue for any public purpose. My suggestion to the commissioners would be kind of in line with what we talked about doing with the revenue is, of course, to use it to reduce the property tax. We all remember that we did a 7.04 cent property tax increase specifically for the capital plan that includes the bonds for the school system and the community college. I would suggest to the commissioners that you consider, if you put Article 46 on the ballot and it passes, that you would consider reducing the property tax by 2.5 cents. That would come off that 7.04 cent amount. So what that would allow is the county would be able to use $3,850,000 for debt service in the plan. That means if you cut the property tax by 2.5 cents, it would reduce the amount of property tax revenue that's going into the plan, right? Going into the debt service for the 20-year debt on all these bonds by the amount of $3.8 million. I would suggest you would then replace that $3,850,000 with sales tax revenue, right? That would leave $2,350,000 that I would suggest the commissioner should consider using for operating costs for the bond facilities. If you remember, we talked about when the new high school comes online, particularly the new high school, the estimate for the new operating costs for the high school are about $1.5 million. We do not currently have that money in our budget. We're not budgeted to take care of it right now. We would have to find revenue when it's built and it comes online, which I think is August of 2023 is the planned time period. We would need to find $1.5 million. All the other buildings for the community college and the school system, just the bond buildings, just the bond related buildings, that the annual operating cost is estimated to be $2,350,000. So what I would suggest the commissioners consider, and this would be part of your resolution, the second part, right? You got the first item that's vote to put it on the ballot. Second part is a resolution where you tell the public this is what we do with it. From my perspective, I would suggest that you cut the property tax by 2.5 cents, replace that $3.8 million worth of property tax and the debt service plan with sales tax dollars from 46, and consider that $2.3 million that would be remaining to be able to be used for operating costs for bond facilities. Now, what that does mean is that for a number of years, you're going to have, there is no operating cost, right? So the high school comes online in 2023, so we'll start that fiscal year paying operating costs. I would suggest to the commissioners that during those years when we're not actually paying the operating costs, but the revenue will be coming in, instead of us creating new spending in an operating budget, we would put those funds in capital reserve until the operating costs came online, then we wouldn't put it in capital reserve anymore. I think the commissioners had mentioned some interest in the possibility of doing enhanced security projects at the schools. If it's in capital reserve, you can use it for that purpose, so we would hold it in a special Article 46 capital reserve, so you would be able to see that money. But once the buildings come online, we would be taking it out of capital reserve and putting it toward the operations of the new college and school system buildings. So the resolution that you have in your packet allows for these uses that I'm suggesting to you tonight. The resolution in there indicates that you would use the Article 46 revenue for education debt service or other education capital costs. When I say other education capital costs, I'm talking about bankrolling, the operating costs for a couple of years, and then if you wanted to use it to do other things for the capital needs for the schools, particularly security, you would be able to do that. The resolution also states that you would use a portion of the Article 46 sales tax revenue for operating costs as the bond facilities come online. The resolution does not specify the property tax reduction of 2.5 cents. The board could change the resolution if you want to do that and have it actually specifically say if this passes, we reduce that by 2.5 cents. I would suggest not going any higher than 2.5 cents. And the reason why is sales tax revenue is more volatile than property tax revenue, right? It's going to come with the economy and go with the economy. We already have about $6.7 million, I believe, of sales tax going into the plan now, right, per the plan as it exists. So the more we augment the capital plan with sales tax, it's a little more risky, right? You can control the property tax by raising it and lowering it. Sales tax, there's just not a whole lot we can do. If it starts tailing off, if we enter into a recession, And please remember, we're talking about a 20-year debt timeline, right? So we're trying to set ourselves up with revenue that we feel will be consistent over a 20-year payback period. So I think it's, from my perspective, it's reasonable to consider a 2.5 cent. If you go beyond the 2.5 cent, we looked at numbers going as high as 3 cent. A 3 cent property tax decrease in supplementing the revenue with the sales tax money does not leave enough for the operating costs for the new school buildings. But understand, commissioners, you can do whatever you want to with this revenue. It is your prerogative to, if it passes with the voters, to spend it however you want. These are my recommendations to you, 2.5 cents and cover the operating costs. So be happy to try to answer any questions. We have Ted from Davenport here tonight. He's also helped us run these numbers and make sure we understand the impact to our plan. So I'll be happy to try to answer any questions.
Have we looked at the projected revenue increase yet for next year on property tax?
I think we're working with the tax department now because we've started our budgeting process right after the budget was approved, right? So
start when you're done.
And our current plan with the 7.04 cent increase builds in a 1% growth over the life of the plan. So we're already figuring in property tax base growth, but we're only figuring in 1%. We did that purposely to try to keep a conservative amount of revenue expected for a couple of reasons. One is we want to make sure there's enough revenue created. We know that construction costs have been going up for the past couple of years. And again, we want to kind of hedge ourselves against an economic downturn with the sales tax. So.
All right.
And we're going to have a recession, just a matter of time. Just a matter of time.
Yes.
If we only designate 2.5 cents to debt service and our 2.5 cent reduction in property tax as a result of a 0.25% sales tax increase, I'm not sure we're going to get the people to vote for it.
I don't think so either.
I think that's the balance the commissioners do have to consider, is that it has to be something attractive enough for the public to consider. But I would just say, again, because the revenue source is volatile, more volatile than the property tax, and we're not talking about an annual budget, just, you know, an operating budget. We're talking about debt for a very long time, very large amounts of debt. I agree with Mr. Lashley. I think we will see, eventually, we will see sales tax start going down.
You can bet on it.
Yes, that's correct. So it is a difficult thing to balance, and that's something. If you put it on the ballot, you'll have to think about what should the property tax reduction be. But again, my recommendations are only recommendations. The commissioners can do
that. Before. Comes around every year.
Yes.
In the budget, I mean, yes. That discussion always comes back around. What do you do? How do you cover what you got to cover? And I agree.
In my opinion, I think we need to lower the tax rate for the people who pay the taxes, with the sales tax. I think whatever comes in on the sales tax, we need to cut at least 4 pennies off that 8 pennies we raise in the taxes. That's what I'm going to recommend.
How much did we see in the revenue increase last year? Property tax revenue increase.
Susan, can you tell me that data? We'll continue to talk, but we'll look at it.
Let me ask you a question.
Yes.
During the whole bond campaign, it was just subtly mentioned at best, and in my opinion, rhetorically, practically whispered, that the operational costs would be there. What were you planning on doing? I mean, you knew it was coming. We knew it was coming. Davenport knew it was coming. Were you just going to, if the sales tax failed, which it did, were you just going to try to raise property taxes again past the 8th or find it in growth?
I think it will have to be, if we don't commit any sales tax revenue to it, if this doesn't pass and we don't commit sales tax revenue, it will be a combination of whatever the board desires, either a property tax increase or cuts to spending elsewhere enough to cover, because we will have to turn the lights on in these buildings. We won't have any choice, I think. Or it could be a combination of growth and property tax increase if sales tax revenue doesn't increase too. So, yes, it will be a dilemma, particularly when the new high school comes on board.
But you're looking at 2023, right?
That's correct. Fiscal year 23-24.
If I could say, I always understood that if the bonds were approved, then there would be a tax increase to pay for the bonds, and then down the road there would be another tax increase. There would be more costs associated with.
I never heard of them.
Yeah. They did.
You did. Projected the cost.
Then. Very subtle at best.
Yeah.
It's almost like we'll cross that bridge when we get to it, and we got to it.
Yeah, we
do. Well, we haven't got there yet. It's 2023.
We're on our way.
How many? So $6.2 million projected annual revenue from the new. Article 46, how much is that in property tax rate and property tax cents?
I'm sorry.
4.5 cents.
The entire 6.2?
Yeah.
I believe that's correct. I think, Susan and Andrew, could you check those numbers? What the 6.2 million would total if we were going to reduce the property tax rate by the entire 6.2 million, what that would equate to?
4.43 cents. I already
figured. 4.42.
4.43, almost. A little less than 4.5.
So if you just round it around 4 cents, we
can. Yeah, round it down to 4 cents, yeah. But now if we look at growth, and did you look at the growth we had last year, wasn't it around $3 million?
I did. I looked at what we collected fiscal year 18 was $71.1 million, and compared to what we have collected for fiscal year 19, year we just finished, was 75.4 million. So that was an increase of 4.2 million for the current year taxes.
So
based upon, go ahead. I was just gonna say, based upon our budget right now for fiscal year 20, and this is incorporating the 8 cent tax increase, we are budgeted to collect 86.8 million.
I understand that is using the property tax increase too. Right. So we expect to see a large increase in property tax revenue.
At the end of the fiscal year, what did we get back the first quarter that, you remember when we when Honeycutt said we were only going to get back about $800,000 at the end of the fiscal year because of what we budgeted and what we spent and so forth and so on, and it came in at a tune of over $4 million. Do you remember
through the accruals, yes, sir.
Whatever. What has it been the last couple years?
Let me
look
that for you. Bear with me just a second.
That's back when the board voted to raise taxes 2 cents. Remember that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then they got in for a windfall. It's simply a windfall of over-budgeting or padded budgets. I would submit it's padded budgets. And David Smith, God bless him, he said, well, if I'd known we would get that big of a windfall, I'd never vote for yeah. tax increase. And then we lowered taxes. You remember that? We voted 2-1.
Yeah.
I mean, 3-2 to lower taxes a penny. And because of the windfall that we got. If you remember that process, Smith voted against
it. Yes, I remember that.
I'm pretty sure he did. I miss old David. How's he doing?
I haven't talked to him lately. He's doing good. He's,
why is he got a home
about he's like a, that? He's about 78. He's... I think he's getting old.
No, wait a minute.
Catching up.
That's right. We're catching up. So what do we need to do in this particular section?
So if the commissioners want to put this item on the ballot for the March vote, the March 2020 primary, you would need to vote tonight to put it on the ballot. Board of Elections needs this pretty quickly so they can get it to Raleigh and get it on the ballot. You do not need to approve the resolution at all. You don't have to commit to do anything with the sales tax dollars. But I think the idea the last time we did this was if you give the public an idea of what you plan to do with the money, that is in their best interest, then when they go to the polls to vote, they'll at least have an idea of what the board has said they want to do. So at the minimum tonight, if the commissioners, and you don't have to put it on the ballot in March, it can go on the ballot next November. The commissioners could do either one. You can only do it one time, though, if it fails.
It could never go on now.
Or it could, absolutely. It could not go on at all. So if the board feels like it should go on the ballot tonight, you would need to vote tonight to put it on the March referendum. And then consider a resolution with detail on what you would do with it. But again, that is not necessary to put on the ballot.
It's not binding either.
No.
That's correct.
The board is going to make that decision made moving forward. Might get one good year out of it.
Well, I'm going to make a motion that we cut the tax rate, but all the money comes in on the sales tax, we cut it off the property tax.
Which is about 4 cents.
Yes. So it's that's 2-4.
Say it again. 4 cents.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
All the money comes in on the mill rate sales tax goes to decrease
above
the
operating costs.
Right.
Okay. Right. You increase the sale, make that the motion yeah. would reduce the property
tax.
Would be
by 4%.
All the revenues would be used to reduce the property tax.
Yeah. I think that would be fair to the taxpayer.
Well, the one thing I've heard more negative comments on it since we brought this up in the community has been the sales tax.
Oh, I've heard a lot of, that's why I think we need to lower the tax rate to the property owners and taxpayers to that amount.
I think the issue that we're getting, the hardest part for us is that once we approve this, it's we got two people sitting over here that are going to rip us a new one.
That's what we get to do big bucks for.
Right. And I'm not afraid to say it. I mean, I don't know why they don't want to look at the benefit, but they don't. And I know that I don't like taxes, but this is one of the fairest taxes we can
live. It's everybody.
That's right.
The absolute fairest tax.
Everybody pays it.
And you don't have to pay for groceries. You don't have to pay right.
for
medicine.
Exactly.
You don't have to pay for gasoline.
Right.
And you can lower your tax rate to the property owners.
And we'll second Bill's motion.
Have you got your figures?
I do, Mr. Sutton. For fiscal year 18, we added $708,600 to our fund balance. And fiscal year 19, these are unaudited figures. We are still going through our annual audit. But preliminary, we look at to add about $3.5 million. 1.1 of that is going to come in from property taxes that were collected above the budget. There's growth that happens within the year, and $1.5 million has been collected more in Article 39. Sales tax.
Mm-hmm.
Those are the two biggest areas that we have seen the biggest detailed growth.
Well, it was presented back during the bonds and the tax referendum that 60% of our sales tax revenue comes from outside the county. Now, I don't know if that's an accurate number, but I just got a number from one of the people that worked on that. I just gave it to Susan. We're the eighth in North Carolina. We're ranked eighth in. I'll read it the way it says. We're ranked eighth in visitor spending in the state. And the dollars, and this was a Times News article, the dollars in outside visitor spending in Alamance County, this was presented in an article prior to the bond vote, was $190.3 million. Now, all we have to do is look at that and compare it to what revenue, the gross revenues are, and that tells us what the percentage, actual percentage of the sales tax is that's coming in from outside the county. And whatever percentage that is, that means somebody else is paying our bills.
Lots of times we're paying it anyway, because you buy something that's a dollar, you don't pay $1.675,
right.
They round it up to $1.07. I don't know what happens to that extra quarter cent, if it stays with the merchant, or if the state gets it, but I know that we're paying it, and I think that I would like to see that stay in Alamance County. If I'm paying it, I would like to see it be used for the benefit of our people.
Well, before we vote, I'm gonna try to be nice tonight, just so best I can be. I'm not gonna call names. I'm trying to point fingers. I want to be able to go home to sleep tonight. And my position is transparency. I support 100% a swap out of sales tax versus property. I was willing to vote for that motion that you made before a couple years ago, where I said, are you willing to reduce all, for property tax, the amount of money you have come in from sales tax? And the board's decision was no. So you ultimately receive a tax increase, if that had been approved. Here, you know, I think it's good that we could reduce taxes. I would heavily tell the public, vote for it, because you are going to have a reduction in your property tax. For the same reasons we're all hearing tonight. But to me, the primary goal is transparency. Why are we doing it now versus in a general election? When we know the numbers are going to be higher, more of the electorate's going to come out. And I've heard the explanations, well, you know, if we do it now, the quicker we can get the reduction in the property tax. I hear that. But as I said in the last meeting, to me that's a red herring. Now, you're pulling that out across the debate trail, trying to get the people over to go with it to vote for it in a non-general election. I think in order to run government the best it can be run, and business for that matter, is put your best foot forward. Be honest and be transparent. Tell it like it is and say, you know, what do you want us to do? And to me, our best foot forward is not putting it in a cycle, in my opinion, of where we think we can get it on and approved the easiest. And I can't be in the head and mind and heart and soul of anybody on this board but me. And I've always believed all my life, sitting here anyway, that people position stuff for
success, or they position stuff for ease and the least of challenges. And to me, I can't feel like I've been transparent if I knew that we had a chance to put it on the ballot in November, when we know that more people are going to come out, good or bad, whether they're going to be the so-called deplorables or not. You may see a backlash, and we may get more people out that might favor this in November than you would
if they're going to get a sales tax reduction.
Yeah, property tax reduction. Well, that's just how you have to weigh your votes. Yeah. My vote is transparency, and I honestly believe the push for this is because it will be easier in our minds, some people's minds, I think, if we do it now versus we have more of a private interest vote, in my opinion. And so I can't vote for anything other than a general election, and I said that from the very beginning, and I'm not backing off of that at all. And I just think that's the most transparent I can be. I know I'm going to get outvoted on this, but I'll be able to sleep okay.
Well, I don't know whether you're going to get outvoted or not, but I personally don't have the issue to me is not timing or anything other than the fact that if we get it done in March, we get to deal with it on the budget for 21-22.
Otherwise, we might as well not even bother to say what we're going to reduce anything, because three of us aren't going to be
here. Three of you won't be here.
That's what I've heard. I mean, we've wasted a lot of time here talking about what to do with it, because you two will decide that.
No, we
won't. We won't be here to talk about it.
I do have one, and I think I know the answer to this question, and this is one that's bothered me, because we can make a resolution that says all of the 6.2 cents or 6.2 million in revenue, or 4 cents, but it's going to leave a little bit of change, goes to reduce the property tax. But to my understanding, there's nothing to prohibit a future board from eliminating that. So we created
one shot at it, and that's all we're going to get.
Right,
you do it in March,
tax, which
do it in November,
might never go away.
Be here forever.
Absolutely, it can be rescinded. Right?
No.
Sure. I believe it can, but
it never will be. The way the government works, it never be.
Well, one good thing about this revenue for you to think about is if the board creates stipulations about what to do with the money. If you say we want to reduce the property tax rate by 4 cents, what I would suggest to you is we would then want to put all the sales tax revenue into the debt service plan. Right. We don't want to do anything. We don't want to cut property tax and then not put the money back in there so we can pay this debt.
Yeah.
But we'll treat it as a restricted sales tax, just like we do for the school system. Now we track the money that the state has set up in two of the articles that we have to give to the schools. So we would track Article 46 revenue the very same way. All Article 46 revenue would be for a specific purpose. So, you know, if the board says we want to cut property taxes by the most that we possibly can, which is what you said so far, and then what the staff would be able to do is, okay, Article 46 revenue, that would come into us. We would know each month how much Article 46 revenue came in, and we would be able to say that those dollars are going into the capital plan. So I think there would be, it's not like it's just general money that you don't know which pile of money it is. It would be possible to track it.
That would be in the bond documents?
No. That won't be on the ballot. No,
it won't be on the back. I'm talking about, but in the bond, in the bucket, in the documents when the bonds are drawn, that won't be.
No, but it would be in our capital plan, which is how we pay for it. So we would have a new column in our plan that says Article 46 revenue. And what you would see is the dollar amounts for that are showing the property tax revenue that's covering the plan costs would be reduced by that same dollar.
So a future board could still change that.
They could, but we would have to determine what to do with the Article 46 revenue. So, if they said we want to pull it out of the capital plan, then that's why I say this is for, you're looking at a very long term, a long horizon here. This is debt that's, you know, at least 20 years. That's how long we plan on financing this. So any future board that pulled money out of the capital plan, we'd have to have some, this is debt. Right, not a program we could cut.
Property tax.
That's right. We would have to do something to pay debt. I mean, that's one thing that when we do the budget, we make tag on sure where we got the debt covered right off the bat.
Right.
Programs and other spending can be cut, but not debt.
Now, devil's advocate, we have a recession. We don't get $6.2 million.
That's right.
Do what you have to as far as
then we're counting on that conservative estimate of property tax base growth, right? We figured a 7.04 cent property tax increase based on 1%. It may actually grow 2, 3, 4, but that's really helping us because eventually we will have a recession and that sales tax will tail off. And we figured a plan that tries to take some of those things into account. We figured I can't remember the interest rate that we used off the top of my head, but was it 4.5? It may be less, it may go up, but again, if sales tax is going up, that's good for us, we can cover that. If property tax is going up, we can cover it. If the interest rate goes down in future debt issuances and sales tax is tailing off, we're hoping that it'll ride together and we'll still be able to pay the debt. The key for us, for me, is we've set the property tax rate at 7.04 cents. We do not want to have to put any more property tax revenue into the plan. We don't want the commissioners to have to raise property taxes anymore to pay for the debt. So we've tried to tailor it to be take all these possible scenarios into account.
Well, the people that live in Alamance County, they're subsisting on fixed income and own their home, or are paying for their home, are paying property tax at the new rate.
Yes.
This is one way to offer them some property tax relief.
Yeah. That's right.
Well, I'm gonna call for the vote in just a second. I wanted to respond to what Mr. Sutton said and just say that I agree that there's a lot of potential for backlash in different ways. And I would say that I agree with what Mr. Carter said, that I don't feel like I'm gaming the system. I want to see my taxes cut, and I want to see the property taxes for the people in the county cut. If we're thinking about maybe, I guess there's an idea that maybe it has a better chance of passing in the primary because it's expected to be a high Democrat turnout because of the nature of the Democratic presidential race. But the Democrats, my understanding is that they don't like sales taxes. They prefer it to be a property tax. That they see the sales tax as being regressive, and that people who have property, I get that pretty loud and clear from their presidential campaigns, that they feel strongly that people with property should pay a higher share of the tax burden. So I'm not sure that it does have a better, and I understand that there's research, and Mr. Sutton has made that available. There's research that says that things have a better chance of passing in the spring, but I'm not really personally buying all that. I just think that the best thing for the county and for the taxpayers of the county would be if we were able to lower taxes in June of 2019 rather than wait until June of 2020. So that's why I support Commissioner Lashley's motion.
And I do too. And one thing about elections, you never know what's going to happen.
That's right.
If you do, you need to go on to Vegas.
So we have a motion and a second to allocate any potential Article 46 sales tax revenue that we haven't put it on the ballot yet. If pending the vote to put it on the ballot, that we would commit as a board to reducing the property tax rate for Alamance County by 4 cents.
Yes.
Is that the?
That's the motion.
That's the motion. So if there's no further discussion, all in favor of that, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed?
No.
Okay, so let's move on to voting on the, I guess it's a resolution to put it on the ballot.
Yes.
What would be the phrasing of that?
Somebody
wants to make a motion.
The resolution calling for March 3rd, 2020 special advisory referendum concerning the levy of 1/4 cent sales tax. That's what we're voting to do.
Okay, if somebody wants to make a motion.
I'll make a motion to that effect.
I'll second it.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
No.
Thank you.
All right, so now we have the Health Department with approval to apply for a grant.
Good evening.
Bring us breakfast, right?
No, I feel like sometimes I need to sip a bag and a pot. So what you have before you tonight is approval to apply for a grant. We are seeking approval to apply for the Community Linkages to Care for Overdose Prevention and Response Grant. And if awarded, be able to budget up to $115,000 from the North Carolina Department of Health and Human Services Injury and Prevention Branch. And so this request to apply as part of that continued community response to the opioid situation that our county has committed to. And I won't go through all the details, but you remember in 2017 the forum and then the follow-up to the forum that came an action plan. And so this proposal is based on two of those focus areas being recovery and treatment and prevention and education. And so if awarded, these funds would be used to hire a data referral manager position that would be tasked with collecting the data from EMS field teams. So this is a collaboration between not only the community at large, but the health department and EMS, and to make contact with the quick response teams to ensure follow-up of the individuals who experience an overdose. Also track the outcomes of those individuals and report that data to the overdose case review team, the Justice Advisory Council, and Project 25 to also make recommendations. Funds would also be used to contract with a consultant to provide things like an environmental scan and assessment of our current system of service delivery for overdoses, and provide recommendations for gaps, scaling, and needs based on stakeholder input. And lastly, the funds would be used to conduct trainings for ODMAP. Burlington PD and Alamance County Sheriff's Office and the Health Department already use ODMAP, which is a geospatial tool to track overdoses, and creates essentially hotspots on a map. And that's really helpful for us as we look at where do we need to put interventions. And currently, we only have two of our law enforcement agencies on that in the health department. So part of this would be to do that.
How long is this grant?
This would be up to three years.
3 years.
So based on your success in year one. So the first year is just $115,000, but then we would be eligible for two additional years. No match for this grant, and no out-of-state travel is anticipated in this proposal.
The problem I have with grants is that it takes those employees and makes them permanent. So I'll make the motion we approve this, that it ends with no employees after 3 years. No new employees.
The intent for this is to be a contract. We have a Public Health Alliance contract that allows us to have staffing through contract.
Okay.
And we do that specifically for grants.
So that will be a contract.
Is that part of it?
That's how we employ our grant positions.
That's good.
That's part.
Good.
I'll second the motion, Bill.
No, what's wrong with it?
Oh, okay. Well, I'll make a motion that we approve the grant.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve the grant. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed?
Thank you.
Okay. World War I monument.
So Scott Ward is our local historian. He's going to do a very, very brief presentation on the World War I monument. We have Alamance County citizens that are affected by it or involved.
Hello.
Hey.
Thank you. All right. I've got it going. All right. Good evening, commissioners. I'm going to try to make this quick. So the North Carolina National Guard Foundation Museum has contacted all the counties. They are raising money and undertaking an effort to build two memorials to the 30th Old Hickory Division Infantry Group. They are, like I said, they're raising money. They're asking for soil from all 100 counties. and they're trying to educate people on North Carolina's role in World War I. So North Carolina basically won World War I. I don't know if you know that or not. So the 30th Infantry was primarily made up of troops from North Carolina, some from surrounding states, but they were tough. These guys were tough. They weren't very well trained, but they were tough. Yeah, absolutely. So, and they were known in World War I for breaking the Hindenburg Line. So, quick history of World War I. It was 4 years of no movement. It was a stalemate. Millions upon millions of people died. Two sides, we had the Allied powers, of which the United States was part, and the Central powers, of which we usually think of Germany, Ottoman Empire. It was a transitional war with it. We were going from the 19th century battle tactics to 20th century, and the result was millions were dead. There was one battle in particular, the First Battle of the Somme. Over a million people died in that one battle. So after that, the Germans fell back to a defensive position called the Hindenburg Line, which made use of the geography of the area. And one of the big parts of the geography it made use of was the Canal de Saint-Quentin. St. Quentin's Canal. This was a canal that connected two rivers that was a massive engineering feat and could not easily be crossed except for one particular area near the town of Bellecour. In Bellecour, this town was mined. It was, the Germans knew this was where they were going to come, and the Allies knew this is where we needed to go. So they decided to make use of this. In August, they began what became known as the 100 Days Offensive. In late September, the Allies were approaching Bellecour, and on September 29th, the battle began. 1,600 guns in less than a day fired 1 million shells. 30,000 of them had mustard gas. Massive battle. The German lines began to break a little bit, and so the 5th Infantry from Australia and the good old 30th Infantry from the U.S. started leapfrogging each other, trying to push the Germans back across that line. And eventually, the 30th did it. They were probably a little overly eager because they ran right past the embankments, past the minefields, and right past the Germans. They turned around and they had both Germans and Australians shooting at them. So that was not a good situation, and quite a few died. Australians love to take credit for this, but we were the ones who broke it. 6 weeks later, Germany had to fall back from this. They surrendered. That was what broke World War I. It came at a cost. 25,000 Allied troops were killed in one day. 242 from North Carolina, 6 from right here in Alamance County. Walter B. Ellis, who I believe his name is on the
American Legion post.
Otis B. Fogelman, Walter I. Foster, Henry W. Johnson, Robert Sutton, and Isham B. Watson. Six of our Alamance County residents who gave their lives on that day. So, the foundation is trying to build monuments. They are building a monument in Noroy, France, which is near Bellecour, and in Raleigh. They're asking for money through private donations. Last time I checked, they've raised about 96%. So if you'd like to donate, they would be happy to receive your donation. They're asking for dirt from all 100 counties. I think Mr. Haygood is looking into a location where we can get the dirt from that's appropriate. They're asking for stories and artifacts. So if any of your relatives served in World War I, they would love to talk to you and receive any kind of donations in that regard. All of this can be done at their website. Just go to ncww1monument.org. We are hoping through our website and our social media to make our citizens aware that this is a great opportunity for them to donate to a great cause. So I'll be happy to answer any questions, and I think Bruce is... Yep, Bruce has pulled up the website right there. So you can see that they are going to dedicate the monument in 19 days and 13 hours. So.
There's a monument in France and here in Raleigh. Again, 100 pieces of dirt. There's a video on it. It's a really good website. We hope that our news organization will publicize this. Six Alamance County citizens gave their life. They're on that wall down there.
Yeah.
So, kind of a big deal.
Yes.
There's a movie coming out in December called 1917. It's a year before in World War I at the Hindenburg Line. Here's going to be pretty dramatic. So, I'm very happy they're at 96%. Maybe we can push them over to 100 or maybe 110.
And if you're wondering why I'm doing this presentation, the gentleman who leads this foundation has been spending a lot of time in the Bahamas trying to help those folks recover from the hurricane. So that's why I'm up here.
So you did a great job.
Thank you.
Yeah, that was your 6-minute presentation.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Scott.
And we need a motion.
No, I think the idea tonight was to use this forum to publicize the fact that the National Guard Association is taking these donations and to just recognize the folks from Alamance County who died in this very specific effort to win World War I. And we'll be sending soil from Alamance County both to Raleigh and to France. We're working on determining where is the appropriate place to take that dirt from. But
we'll got some dirt you can spare.
We'll be sending it to, we'll probably talk with the Walter Ellis Post and just see if they have any suggestions, if they know Walter Ellis's home perhaps, or maybe the site, the Ellis Legion site was over at Willowbrook Park, maybe from that site, but we'll find somewhere appropriate to send soil from Alamance County to France.
That's
so.
Going to be my suggestion, Willowbrook Park.
Yes, yes, right there at the former Legion Hut location, perhaps, yes.
Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm. Emergency management has a budget amendment.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I'm here to ask your permission for a budget amendment in the amount of $52,828. We received a grant from Homeland Security to purchase a prime mover, which is a large truck to pull generators, heavy trailers, equipment. It would be used to pull these trailers and stuff to shelter sites and generators. It's 100%. The county has no match.
So what kind of truck is it? I mean, it's a large truck.
It's a large truck. We don't know yet. We're still getting bids. We're trying to get it in the amount that they gave us. So it's just
going to work.
Not a tractor trailer,
no,
but like a
just big, like a four-wheel drive,
yeah,
large.
A dually. Something like a dually.
Okay.
Yeah.
You're not going to get
about
$52,000.
I know. We've had a few quotes so far that's been close, but we're still working.
That's a good price, $52,000.
And we needed it. It's the generator that we have. It's really tough to pull with the truck we have right now.
I'll make a move that we approve this.
I'll second.
We have a motion and a second to approve that budget amendment. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Great, thank you. All right, we have one more public speaker signed up, Charlie Deaton. I think he left.
Yeah,
he gave up.
He said give us our best.
So,
Charlie said give us our best.
No public speakers, so I assume no commissioner responses. Mr. Haga, do you have a county manager report?
I do not.
And so do we have any commissioner comments tonight? We have on our agenda, we have to a closed session to do some personnel matters. The reason that these were scheduled for October is in thinking about the course of the year. If they routinely did employee evaluations in November, then you may be having new commissioners who would be evaluating an employee where they didn't have any experience, knowledge of that employee. That's not the case this year. So since it's 10 o'clock, I make a motion we table the personnel discussion to November the 4th.
I'll second that. So you only made that
for a budget. 4 seconds on that
one. So all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Great. So we're adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners occur on the first and third Monday of every month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Grand. Typically, the first meeting of the month occurs at 9 a.m. and the second meeting occurs at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on LocalGov TV. Please go to www.localgovtvnc.com for more information about this schedule and to see more videos produced by your local governments. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com or at our YouTube channel. Technical questions regarding this meeting's broadcast or production may be sent to our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. This address is for technical questions only. Comments and questions about the content of the meeting may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. There, you can click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes and agendas of commissioner meetings, and find other information about the county commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.